I'm Madman Robbie. Welcome to the Hong Kong Hub and the first one-shot I'm doing. I am with a lot of other people. Say hi, people.
Hello, everyone.
Yes, I'm so happy we can finally get this show off the ground because I was afraid that my head was going to explode setting it all up. So, everybody, join your favorite silky, smooth, suave supervillain in his Shadowrun adventures. Stop doing that. The night lights of Hong Kong flare harsh, warm colors against the ever-present brown smog choking the city. Classical wheeled cars, stubbornly defiant to time, struggle to drive alongside grid-nav-assisted auto cars beneath the sleek hovers skimming a few meters overhead. The large crowd of mostly orcs shuffles around in cheap tissue paper and nylon clothes, bustling from one place to another, hoping to avoid the gaze of the patrolling knight-errant officers. Cold, sobering lights pour out from enterprised and decayed storefronts, holding on to dear life with just enough new yen to keep those chilling lights on, while flanked by blank, ultra-stylized structures of stucco, stone, and glass, whose only purpose only became clear when dropping into the augmented reality overlay, where the street signs and remaining storefront lights disappeared beneath a roaring tide of Tridio advertisements, conflicting audio from countless sources, in the eye-rending storm of day-glow lights. Blank surfaces like roads, walls, and even the underside of some hover cars display the garish sensory quagmire. As for the players in Hong Kong, let's get a little background and introduction. Coach, introduce yourself and your character.
My name is Coach Ben. I'm playing Jennifer Powers, a.k.a. J-Pow. She is a elven female gymnastics adept. She uses her powers for stealth, climbing up walls, and general breaking into places where she doesn't belong and acting like she does.
Anything in terms of character we need to know, or will that be done later?
She was the child of a corporate sinner who was doing some very high-tech research, and that research came home and basically devastated her whole family, and she managed to escape and has been living off the grid since then, and she's just fresh onto the street.
Okay. And Deddy, what about you?
It's Deadeye, excuse me?
D-E-D-I. You're right, it's my nephew's.
My name is... Yes, this character that I am playing is Deadeye. I am just Connor. But Deadeye is a Cretan Cyclops who, from a very, very young age, wanted to explore and decided that the best way to get money and food while he was exploring is to, hunt. Because he was always a very, very, very good archer. And somehow, after a long, 4 years out just journeying aimlessly in the great expanse of the sixth world, he found himself in Whampoa, or just Hong Kong in general, where he basically has been living in a coffin motel. Friendly, so don't be scared by how big he is.
Okay. And Huli Jing, what can you tell us about you?
Well, pretty much anyone who's still alive would know me only by Huli Jing. Though I guess I have a feeling. I've been living mostly off the grid my entire life. The deck I have, which I forget the make and model at the moment, I've had since pretty much as long as I can remember. I'm only about 20 years old. Bald dwarf, wearing a plain armored jacket. I carry myself a lot more confidently than I probably should, but there's a reason people call me the man with the golden screwdriver. I've mostly been getting by taking deck jobs here and there, you know, real small-scale stuff, until a little while ago I had a pretty big job come my way that landed me with a lot of, quote-unquote, a lot of money that I've spent on all the rest of my gear that I have. Wasn't enough for a car.
Aww.
But, that's me.
You know, if you're able to stay off the grid and be a decker, you might actually be the single greatest hacker I know. That's some Watchdogs level bullshit right there, and I love you for it.
Yeah. I like to think I've been completely off the grid.
And the fifth member... Wait, hold on. Oh, you got moved. The fourth member of our little, motley crew here, Slight! Who the hell are you?
Who's
it? Slight or Sleet, however you pronounce that?
Slate. Change it to Shay Shout, but Slight in Chinese.
No.
I'm gonna make you all pronounce that every time.
Oh, okay. It's phonetic.
I'm gonna call you Sushi halfway through.
No, you're not like the Japanese in Hong Kong. No.
Zhao is a mystic and an alchemist for the Wampo and Elders. Every time anybody sees a character around, they're always wearing a full face mask and like hooded cloak. Hard to determine even like the gender, the exact. It's obviously not an orc or a dwarf, so it's got to be either he or elf, basically everyone
with any intelligence could probably put together.
She's like 6 foot tall. It's a female, but the sort of the backstory and like gender, nobody really know any of that. Or right off the bat.
Are we sure that she's not a dwarf with gigantism?
Pretty sure. Suffer.
What about a troll with dwarfism?
Look at her gloves. She doesn't have big, thick fingers, so probably not. she's like basically, she's almost. She's like all but known by the one going out, basically. Like, she's full on sold for them. Like, sure, not sold. She's like full on sold for them. Like, as a child, so it's basically dedicated her entire life to them.
Okay, anything else?
Not really. She's always walking around like full on, like, dark black cloaks, like a suit, basically. A crimson sky suit and the Argento coat, if you like know what that looks.
Yes, I do, actually.
Yeah. She's always walking around wearing that with a cloak over it and face mask on. She's pretty secretive and talks through a voice warper. So. Oh, yeah, she runs a magic shop for the poet.
Ah, cool.
Not by herself. She is like with a couple people that also work with her.
We don't assume genders on this channel. We have like three women in this group already. What are you talking about?
It's not gonna be a sausage fest.
Okay, last but not least, although my patience is already running out, so he's the most likely to be slapped with a fish. Von Zook, what about you?
I'll be playing Fishy Von Zook, a drone rigger, picker up knowing nothing more than his drones as his friends. The only real family he's ever known are the Wampum Elders.
Anything else?
That's pretty much it.
Okay.
He's an orc.
So, you guys are doing as you do in your own personal lives, when one by one, you're summoned by an unknown number to an unknown host in VR with an unknown encrypted code sent via ghost text.
How do you use this thing? This is the least fishy thing to happen to me all day.
Well, you guys should probably follow the link.
I've got solid...
Oh, yeah, I do remember you telling me that, actually. A while ago. Alright, so...
J-Pal's excited. She needs some cash.
Shh. When you jack in to VR, you see the Hong Kong grid before you, a collection of ruby pagodas going off in every horizontal direction, seemingly without end, in a sea of dancing lights of multiple colors representing the people and things in the city. Overhead is a blinking node, the one sent to you, in an empty space where nothing floats. As you approach it, you find your personas warped into a rather busy, wood-plated bathhouse, with jade and stone sculptures, ornaments, tapestries, oil paintings, and classical guzheng music seeping from nowhere and everywhere. As you guys look around, a wooden table and chair set falls from nowhere in the middle of the room, seemingly without the several dozen bathers or waitresses knowing. The chairs pull themselves back, and a pair of human geishas with their cheongsams undone in the front invite you to sit. In a chipper tone, one tells you Mr. Who will be here momentarily. So, what do you guys do?
Does not have VR capabilities, so he's watching this on his Meta Link on his AR. He's going, he's amazed at this technology.
I mean, Hooli would be hot simming the entire time.
Are you gonna try and like hit on one of the geishas or something?
I'm going to eye them up and down, but I don't swing that way.
See, like if you, I'm trying to wonder like how much does the nerve link work in hot sim? Sure.
Well, in hot sim, it's all the way up to
death,
like olfactory and whatnot. So I can anyone in hot sim can smell, taste, hear, feel the weight of anything within the virtual world, so long as it's emitting.
Okay. Things.
So
well,
I could smell the perfume of the geishas. Or...
Yes. Well, I was asking because I figured one of you guys might be in hot sim and then try to have sex with one of them.
Gross. I'm not watching that.
It's like, turn off the phone. So, they said Mr. Wu will be, or Mr. Who will be here momentarily, so what do you guys do?
So, J-Pal makes that snappy, like, oh, who? Who are we waiting for? Like chomping on a piece of gum, like a noxious kind of thing.
Like, Mr. Who?
I see.
Yes, I believe J-Pow is like one quarter Japanese or something, but looks white, very golden complexion.
I would hit up one of my other Decker buddies and try and get them in on this as like backup.
What do you mean?
So, I didn't import my contacts, but one of my contacts is Lang Chun, another Decker friend of mine. So I basically just send him a quick comm and be like, hey, there's some shady BS going down over here in this nick of the Matrix. Mind coming on over here?
Well, you would have to send him the link that you got.
I would do that.
Okay. And what is his persona exactly?
He would take on the form of a fox, a simple red fox, because he's not very imaginative. But Huli would take on the form of basically himself, but with lots and lots and lots of really expensive looking tattoos. And the face obfuscated.
Okay, makes sense. And what about the rest of you guys? What do you do while you're waiting for Mr. Who? Because the table is still there with the chairs out for you.
Okay, well, Deadeye is actually... I didn't get a chance to say this, but he actually spends most of his free time in, like, a pawn shop that's in Whampoa, where he constantly harasses the pawn shop owner about pretty much every single item and whatever. So right now he's pointing vigorously at his comp link and shouting at how cool this is right now to his to the pawn shop.
Like, will you believe this shit? There's naked women! Who would have thought you could use the Matrix to look at naked women?
This is the most incredible revolution in my entire life.
Von Zook's gonna casually, even shyly, walk up and sit down.
And Sleet?
I guess I'm gonna sense, because everything was moving around all weird. Just try to figure out what the fuck's going on.
All right. Well, you have to roll in a sensing check.
I am actually going to roll a matrix perception.
I was gonna say.
And just keep doing that. Like, as many times as I possibly can.
Before Mr. Who gets here?
And when and after he's here.
Okay. So, Shabahai. How do you pronounce it again? Is it Slate or Shabahai?
Slate. Slight, I guess.
Okay. Slight. So, Slight. You can tell that you are, in fact, in the Matrix. You are not on LSD. And nothing here has an astral signature. It's ones and zeros as far as the eye can see. And if you squint really hard, you might be able to see a two.
Sorry. Two is my trigger word.
Oh, awesome. Everybody say two.
No.
Two.
Okay, so roll your matrix perception. No, just, Julie, because he's the decker.
Oh, goddammit.
Is your sheet being a dick?
Yeah, it doesn't already have, matrix spotting in it.
Oh, did it not, come up right?
No, it's just gonna take me, like, 5 seconds to... Situation modifiers. Right.
Pardon the rustling sound you guys might be hearing. Something fell and I'm having to... I have my laptop on my lap, I have the book over here, I have my can of Pepsi over here, I have my freaking dog sitting on my feet, so moving around without knocking something over is a bit of a challenge.
Nice.
Okay! Three successes! Ugh. So, yummy. Huli, as you do a matrix perception test, excuse me, you see that the bathers are actually all matrix users, whereas the waitresses and the geishas are all actually VIs, programmed into the setting by the host.
I'm gonna send a mark request to all of the personas that I can see here that aren't those two, so I can basically with a little note that says, hey, let me have a mark on you and I can send you DNI. That's how that works.
Oh, you mean the other people in the other people who got summoned with you?
Yes.
Oh, okay. So, are you guys going to accept it?
But I just give you my number, you can send me DNI.
J-Pal accepts DNI, she's got the
drone. Alright.
And, well, there's more stuff you see, so tell me when you're ready.
I press the button that says yes.
Well, that's going to take an action. Okay, so... you also see, with your perception, there's, like, weird strings going up the walls. Like, mono wires. They're not there. Like, people are walking past them. Or, like, there's some in the middle of the room that people are walking through. So they're not physically there. But there's, like, wires coming out of the floor and going up the walls.
Right.
And I'm able to see this now?
No, only he can. Because he did the matrix perception.
Yeah.
How do I make Doctor Who get here? What button do I press to... Where is this?
Although, do any of you guys have knowledge skills relating to, Taoism or Chinese culture? That'll work.
Well, I have area knowledge, wasn't it? Yeah. Fuck me, did it not? Did that work? Did skills?
Would what work?
Area knowledge,
yeah, that'll work.
I'm a dude. Shoot.
See, I'm...
Fuck me.
France is lovely this time of year. In Deadeye, you notice two things that are a little odd. The tapestries hanging from the ceiling have a pentagram style star on it, with each point having the characters for earth, metal, air, water, and fire on it. And you also notice that some of the tapestries, or some of the oil paintings in there, are actually not antiques. They're modern paintings done like old antiques.
This was made by some amateur Western, I bet. Can't even get the specifics right. Concerning. It smells like something not so good. Keep your eyes peeled. And by that I mean, look around, and be careful.
So are you guys going to make more perception tests?
If they start saying that they're worried, I'm going to get up from the chair and start backing away from the table. Slowly.
And the rest of you?
I'm going to stick around. But I'm not sitting in those chairs.
I'm gonna say that after a couple minutes, it occurs to Deadeye that the people, like the icons that he's seeing, are actual people. So he'll start trying awkwardly to make contact with them. Just being like, hello! Hi, what are you, how are you?
JP face palms and was like, oh, what have I gotten myself into?
Well, your questions are answered when the paper sliding partition is slid open. And a figure a figure in a wine red hanfu, flanked by large topless men in purple robes of their own, enter. The man in red takes a seat at the head of the table with his companions behind him, arms crossed over their chests, and stare forward with stone faces. And he waves at you, saying, please, take a seat.
I think I'll stand if that's alright.
And the rest of you?
JPal says, Oh, I would love, or it's very kind to meet your acquaintance, and I'd love to shake your hand, sir.
Alright, so he smiles and shakes your hand. He's happy to be, he's happy to have you here.
J-Pal's gonna try and plant a stealth tag on him when she shakes his hand.
Okay. Yeah.
Oh, wait, that's right, never mind.
I was like, this is some next level shit right here.
Yeah, I had to stop and think for a second. It's like, wait a minute, can you do that in the Matrix? Hold on. What's your deck rating?
Well, no, it's the Matrix, so none of this is actually.
No, it's none of it's real. So I was just thinking of a funny, silly, like, palm death, but no. Cancel all that. I'm just gonna, play cool.
Hello, I think your dress is nice.
Ah, thank you, Mr. Deadeye. I have heard much of your skill, and I am happy to have professionals at my table.
Thanks.
And I understand you are all in need of work? Ah, glad you asked. So he, slaps his palm on the table, and when he pulls it up, he pulls up, a green pneumotube. And then when he twists it, it unfolds sideways like a scroll, and it actually shows a set of jade jewelry. It's a big necklace, earrings, a choker, a headband, a set of 8 rings, and a jeweled belt. And he says, I would like you to retrieve this. And
it's in your head. Mission accomplished, boys. Let's go home.
God damn, you guys are good.
Jump up and snatch it out.
50 karma for everybody. Good job.
But he gives a slight push and it floats over to you guys. And he says, "It is located in a high-end shop in Kaifeng. I would like it recovered." And delivered to Mimi Tsu, a woman who is a clerk at Hong Kong Central Library. If you do this, I can pay you individually 3,200 New Yen.
Yeah, sounds good.
Good.
Right. I want to do area knowledge Hong Kong.
Alright.
Find out where the area where the thing is. I'm sorry.
Oh god, I don't have a map. I don't have a map! Hold on. I'm going off memory here. Did you both roll area knowledge? Okay, so you both know that Kaifeng is somewhat on the western end of Kowloon Island. Because Hong Kong consists of 2 islands. The northern island is Kowloon, and on kind of the southwest of the main island is where you have Kaifeng. And then if you go across Victoria Harbor to the north side of Hong Kong Island, to the kind of east area of Central, is the Hong Kong Central Library.
Nice.
If you pull up Google Maps, why don't you do that? Why don't you just use the frickin' Matrix and pull up Google Maps. I'm sure Google's one of the AA corporations of
2079.
I
believe it was bought out by designated space or no. We got a whole bunch of extra people.
We got
a whole bunch of extra people, but I don't see.
Hold on a second. Let me open up the map! Yeah, from... where the hell is it? Kaifeng.
Huh? Let's the search program. See if I can't find it a little faster.
I guess I'm going to create one of my...
A mile is half a kilometer, right?
I believe so. It's about that much.
Oh, I'm sorry. A kilometer is half a mile.
It, more like three quarters.
Oh, okay. Well, it's roughly 16 kilometers from the magic store in Kwai Fang to the Hong Kong Central Library.
So that's 9 miles. That's almost 10 miles.
Around that. And you have to cross Victoria Bridge.
Weird USA people.
And both of the bridges going over Victoria, because you guys have Hong Kong knowledge, you are very well aware of this, are heavily guarded by knight errant. And gone now. You rolled your perception. Or Huli, that's who he is, people watching.
I tried to make it say my name, but apparently for some reason it did not feel like it.
No problem. I actually have your character's name up there, so I can see it.
Ah, okay.
So you rolled another perception, and is this regular perception or matrix perception?
It's, matrix perception using the search program to, pull up a thing of basically Google Maps, and I would send.
Oh, okay.
Send that general area that you described. I'd send that to everybody.
Okay.
Just in case, just to be safe.
Yep. The highway actually takes you to Victoria Bridge and into Hong Kong, Hong Kong. So it shouldn't be that long of a drive. Although you have to actually, you know, steal the jewelry.
So then you have to steal jewelry and then travel 10 miles through, is it two barricades? Or two?
You only have to go through one, though.
One barricade, a whole bunch of knight errant, and then get it to a library.
Yes. And also he tells you that Mimi Tzu is there from 6 p.m. to 11 p.m. weekdays. And it's currently Sunday. Sunday night.
Okay, so we've got a day to figure this all out.
Yeah. Roughly. Oh, but he does also tell you one thing. At the latest, it needs to be delivered to her by Wednesday. No later than Wednesday.
Yeah, okay.
Any questions?
Would you be willing to negotiate the price?
Yes. I suppose.
I'm thinking, just to throw a number out there, if anyone has any objections, 5,000 each.
It's gonna be a mighty persuasion.
Let me
with negotiate. I believe that we are likely to be worth that, especially to recovering such an expensive object.
Well, this is.
He laughs.
It's a good thing you're helping me with that. The way assisting works is.
I know how it works. I just find it funny.
That was one of the best case scenarios because I rolled 2 dice.
And you have a social limit of 5. What happened?
I put nothing in the negotiation.
Great, but it's not terrible.
Okay. So he ponders and thinks, and he says to you, "The most I can pay on this job is 3,500. That is all I am allotted for this, since it is not official business. That is, of course, to each of you. 3,500 to each of you."
That sounds great to me. Yeah, that sounds good. How about you, everybody? Does that sound good to you?
I think you can do better, old man.
I like to think you said that you could do better, old man, and then you just like, punched him in the face. That's the first thing that came into my mind, just the way you said that.
No, she says, you can do better, old man, and then does a back handspring.
Yeah, he does what?
My character does a back handspring. Flips over backwards, lands on her hands, and then steps down like she was just walking back.
See, look at this. We've got a competent team. I understand that you have certain limitations, certain restraints, but perhaps you might have some other non-monetary resources that you could heft our way to help us with our job.
Yeah, not all of us even have cars. Come on.
Ah, okay then. So, he claps his hands. And another one of the geishas comes out from behind the sliding partition with the top of her cheongsam undone. And she's holding a... It's meant to be a golden tray, but it's kind of translucent. Like it was a, you know, a graphic designer's first day project, you know? So it's kind of like a holographic, clearly translucent golden tray. Hold on a second, I need to find something, because I did not think it would get to this.
My favorite feeling as a GM, when the players spring something on you that you weren't expecting.
Oh, don't worry, I was... I have the resources to handle it, though.
I just learned to expect the unexpected. You kind of got to scroll this, too. And expect that, no matter what you plan out, your players are sideways at some point.
Hold on, that's why I don't specifically plan shit. I just have, like, a frame.
Yeah, sorry, like, this is, like, my fourth session of Shadowrun ever, so I'm gonna derail it on accident.
Oh, dude, no problem. I'm fine with my play. I love it when my players come up with weird shit. So he says,
I've been really excited to play this character because I'm a no shit real life gymnastics instructor in real life. So my character is a super awesome magical gymnast.
Oh, cool. Are we gonna have like a Mirror's Edge style chase scene?
Well, she can walk up walls, she can skate across air, she doesn't leave footprints, like she's got some badass gymnastics-y sneaking abilities. So I'm really excited.
Okay, guys.
I look forward to Deadeye trying to follow.
Oh, that'll be fun.
Guys.
He's actually really good at
sneaking.
Hello.
Yes.
So, he takes the golden tray, or he puts his hand on the golden tray, and he pulls out like a white crystal ball, right? Sets it on the table, taps it, it disperses, and you each have like a small thing in your hand. Like a small white ball in your hands. And he says, "While I do not have the money to pay you, I can give you assets. And, since you are lacking vehicles, what do you say to each of you, a Yamaha Kaburaya?"
I'm gonna
roll a motorcycle.
We're gonna real quick search. That up.
Let me... Can I paste it? I don't think I can. Crap. I tried copy-pasting it. It didn't work. Copy-paste didn't work, guys. We're all doomed.
That's not good.
We've lost the internet, guys. Copy-paste didn't work.
It's in Rigger 5. Yamaha Kaburaya. Man, Yamaha TVs have gotten really mobile since the last time I went into one of their stores.
Those are $17,000 a piece.
Mm-hmm. If it is not to your liking, I'm sure you can find a fence who will take it for a handsome sum.
I agree to these terms, but does anybody have skill and the bug even?
Wait, would you ask?
Well,
I have a tag eraser that would erase any bugs that were on these.
Oh, he'll like legally transfer them to you.
that sounds great. Yeah. I'm down for that.
That's awesome. That's really cool.
All right. I think that's pretty reasonable.
Keep those orbs, by the way.
Wait,
keep those orbs. He says, like, holding out a hand. They will be. You may use the bikes, and they will be yours upon completion of the job, but for now, they are merely 5-day rentals.
Good.
So if you get, like, pulled over on them, you can just, like, show the cop the orb in VR, or in AR, and say, like, hey, look, I have permission for the owner to be driving this.
Yeah, I have permission from the guy who's paying me to heist some shit.
It's like, hey, I might have been speeding, but I'm legally using this bike to go steal an expensive set of jewelry.
I like your game plan. That seems reasonable. I don't think anyone here would have any with that.
Very well. And he stands, puts his hands in front of his chest, and bows. And he turns to leave, and before he goes back into the partition, he stops, turns, and says, one more thing. When you see Mimitsu, tell her I said happy birthday. And then he leaves behind the sliding partition.
Would you?
Tell Mimitsu this, to have a happy birthday. I don't trust it. Maybe I'm too paranoid, and I don't trust it.
I don't trust it either for some reason. I don't trust it.
So are you guys going to do anything before you jack out?
Hi. So we should meet. Would you like to meet? I'm Deadeye.
Well, good to meet you, Deadeye. There's a nice noodle shop nearby, and I would ping an AR, I would ping somewhere, like a nice low-cost noodle shop that I know about.
There is a Nutri-Paste kiosk where they have steamed noodles and pork buns.
That sounds delicious.
Sounds fucking terrible.
Hey man, it might be Nutri-Paste, but it's still a pork bun.
And more than likely, it'll be the best meal you've had all day. And by best, I mean all.
I was gonna say, have you eaten at all today?
Knowing Hooli,
did
he
you
probably
get a name from the Johnson, or is she just the Johnson?
Wait, who?
The Johnson. Oh, that was who?
Yeah, that was Mr. Who.
Ran this joke.
I was gonna say, oh god, no. Quick, leave before somebody starts making owl references. God damn it.
Alright, Deadeye hangs up.
Wait, where are you guys gonna meet?
At that place.
The
I'm gonna pick a slightly better place that's close by to that one.
Oh, Deadeye's going to that noodle place. Oh, terrible. He hung up before you made the change. He doesn't know.
Say, Deadeye needs his noodles.
Are you connected to one poet at all?
Me?
Deadeye.
He's been working on... I said that he, like, knows Elder Dwan sometimes, but that's just, like, a couple jobs away.
See, I believe he would know Elder Nuan.
Yeah, other than that, he doesn't get out much, so he doesn't really have a lot of connection.
But he definitely
knows where that bean paste place is.
Motorcycle to right for him. I guess we'll tell the motorcycle. Because motorcycles obviously have a pilot rating or something, right?
I'd imagine.
As long as it has something, tell it to pick me up.
Hold on. Oh, and when you look at the thingamajig bobs, hold on. Let me make sure I have not completely dropped acid. Okay. You can see that the motorcycles, like where they are left, is in Aberdeen, Hong Kong.
Aberdeen's a city in Washington near Seattle.
Oh, there's also an Aberdeen, Hong Kong. By the way, where are you guys, like, on the Hong Kong map, where are you guys meeting to eat?
It'd be somewhere in Wampoa Gardens. Yeah, let's just go to the Wampoa Gardens, Steve. It'd be around that.
Is there like a Google Maps for Hong
Kong? Yeah, I'd go to... No, I'm using the actual Google Maps of Hong Kong. I'm just using the Google Maps default.
Well, I thought that we were going to that, the noodle or bean place, or pork place.
Well, there's a kiosk. that doesn't really narrow it down.
Well, let's meet at one that's near-ish to the job site.
Okay. So, somewhere in, Kwaifong?
Yeah,
Kwaifong. Okay. So that would make the motorcycles about a 25-kilometer walk away.
Can we summon them to drive to
it? You can. They are grid nav connected.
Sure, but it would still take a while. Maybe not.
Since I'm a rigger, can I get mine to drive to me?
Yeah, well, you all can.
Yeah, because of grid guide.
Grid guide. I've been saying grid nav, haven't I? Grid guide.
It's basically the same thing.
Right.
Big portions of well-populated areas basically have an automatic section that every vehicle, almost every vehicle, is automated for.
Right.
So.
Oh, guys! Also, just so you know, there are drone piloted.
Shadowrun Hong Kong map. I found it.
I'm sorry, what were you saying, Luke?
There are several yellow and red drone piloted auto double decker buses that you can catch. Like, you just whistle and it'll, like, kind of go out of the way to you. And it also runs on grid guide and it's driven by a drone. But you can pick it up, slot some Hong Kong dollars into the thing, and then ride it to where you want to go.
I think I'm going to use public transportation for J-Pow, and then I will summon that bike.
Well, the buses are public transportation.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Take the bus.
And
I would also... I'd go to the place so that I was the first person there as best as I possibly could manage.
Are you going to the noodle shop?
Yes.
Okay.
I was the one that suggested it, so it'd be a real dick move if I wasn't the first person there.
No shit. There's Kwaifong. I've been trying to find it on the map. Yeah, it's in Kwaifong Plaza.
Right.
Which is, stop being a dick, Google Maps, a rather high-end mega mall, actually. It's like 15 stories. It's like 5 square acres, like how much it takes up. You know, this is the Shadowrun version, obviously. The real Kwaifong Plaza isn't that big. It actually has its own gravity bar. Where it's like...
That sounds like fun.
It's like an open circular room, or an open orb-shaped room with no gravity, and the bar is like a little area in the nucleus of the room.
When J-Pal sees that, she's going to get really excited and go running towards it.
Go, whee! In zero gravity.
Absolutely.
But the noodle shop is on the second floor on an overpass. And yes, the mall is actually so big, it has like its own little hover scooters that go on magnetic strips.
J-Pal will stay in that zero gravity park until somebody comes and retrieves her.
Going to be a problem then. Deadeye
is
going to
head right to that noodle place
because
he's hungry.
in the event that I should beat Deadeye there, I would like to buy him.
Make a hauling ass check to see who gets there first.
All right.
What is that?
Can you beat this one die in agility? I bet you can. Ooh, I'm a goddamn speed.
Okay, Deadeye, roll your agility.
Do I get a bonus for being hungry?
Yes, you get plus two. Actually, because you're a hungry troll, you get plus three.
That's racist.
It's true.
Well, he doesn't get out much, so that's why he's like,
I have five wounds.
So, you dash your ass onto the nearest bus, like, deposit 50 new yen to the drone. It takes you to Kwai Fong Plaza, and you just thunder off the bus and up the escalator to the second floor kiosk. And all the orcs in the way are, like, stepping aside, because they're like, oh shit, hungry Cyclops. Because you did say Cyclops, right?
Yes, I am a Cyclops.
Just making sure. Well, that's perfectly fine in Hong Kong. Yeah, they kind of just... They step aside and clear the way between you and the noodle stand.
Oh, I'm also wearing a ghillie suit, I guess. I forgot that I had that.
Oh, just a casual ghillie suit.
Just a casual ghillie suit.
Everyone get out of the way, this bush is raging!
Fucking Psycho Bush! It's Psycho Bush, run!
We need this animated.
Yes. Somebody.
Yes, I'm wearing a ghillie suit.
Somebody make a Psycho Bush cartoon. Anyway. So the portly orc man behind the noodle stand sees the Psycho Bush approaching, and then they kind of look at him and says, "Are you hungry, sir?"
Absolutely.
All right. It is 5 new yen or 5 HKD for a bowl of steamed noodles with chicken.
Put down 10 and tell him to keep the change and keep them coming.
Okay. So he gives you a bowl, and it's kind of a small bowl in your hand. It's kind of like the shot glass of soup bowls to you.
Sorry. I just laughed out loud at that. No.
Well, the shot glass of soup.
It's a soup bowl. It's beautiful.
It is. And by the time everybody else gets there, you have like 10 bowls, so that's another like 90 new yen. Or another 100 new yen, I guess.
I'm not that crazy. I'm going to stop after 30.
Yeah. Okay. And because you are such a great client... And you actually lick the bowls so clean, he doesn't even have to wash them. He can just put them back on the shelf. He gives you a free pork bun.
See, that man's going places.
Thank you.
He understands how to keep clients coming back.
I definitely will be coming back.
Every 2 soup bowls, you get a free pork bun. So, you know, if you spent 40 new yen and got a 4th soup bowl, you would have gotten 2 pork buns.
I spend another 10 new yen.
And you get another soup bowl and a pork bun.
Yes.
This is more satisfying than the actual run. And the rest of you guys,
Hong Kong Rush.
You see each. Oh no, Hong Kong Rush is the other one. It's okay.
More like the Hong Kong Food Rush, am I right?
The rest of you guys recognize each other from the Matrix as you get to the mall. And you go up and you see this bush with horns and one eye. This hunched over, devouring all of the pork buns and the... Well, 2 pork buns and all the soup at this guy's stand.
I'm just gonna, real quick, run another Matrix perception and see if this guy is the same... Is one of the same people that I saw during the meet?
I don't think he knows enough to, like, switch his comlink to, like, silent or to, like, or, like, shut it down. So, yeah, probably.
So, Yes, this is in fact the same guy you were talking to, or who was on his comm link. And you also see around you that the marble floors and the white stucco walls that are normally featureless are now glowing with hundreds of different colors. There is not a single bit of white stucco wall anywhere. When you switch into augmented reality and do your matrix perception, it looks like a fucking rainbow gay pride parade. It just got smacked all over the mall by Richard Simmons.
Ooh, pretty.
And all this, like, sweet plastic that you feel like you could eat off of.
I'm going to very seriously consider just buying a subscription to the public grid so I don't have to deal with this shit. For now, I won't.
And also, all of the stores, like the hundreds of stores, and even some of like the better-off kiosks have trid projections of very beautiful men and women promoting their stores. Like, you know, this poor guy serving all the soup, you know, he's not one of the better-off kiosks. The best he can afford is a dancing monkey in a fez standing on top of his sign.
That man has my new yin. Alright, shove all the Calvin Klein models in my face you want. That monkey, that man gets my business.
Well, he gives you his... Well, so do you all just go up to him and start buying soup?
I would, yes. I would buy 3 bowls of soup.
Well, remember, if you get 4 bowls, you get 2 pork buns.
Alright, I'll buy 4 bowls. I'd like one of them here, the other 3 to go, and I'd like to buy a bottle of sake.
Alright, so he smiles, and he reaches down to the cabinet, hands you, like, a little plastic, unmarked bottle of sake, takes out some cling wrap, and kind of wraps up the Tupperware containers of soup, and he hands them to you. And he also hands you, like, in the wrapping, like, between the case and the actual plastic wrapping itself, is, like, a silver little package. And he says, if you store it for more than a week, the flavor will fade. Add that to it, mix it, and microwave it, flavor will come right back.
Right. How much do I owe this man?
40 New Yen.
Alright, I'm gonna give him 140.
Ah, thank you! And because he appreciates your business so much, he gives you his business card. And you have a new contact.
Fuck yes. What's his name?
You have...
What's this man's name?
Phi Lao.
Okay, so this last link is the other 3 Google Maps for Hong Kong all put into one thing, so you don't have to look at 3 stupid maps.
That's the guy's name, Phi Lao.
Also, thank you. Good man.
Yeah, no problem.
Good man.
Thank you very much.
I didn't want to look at all 3. It was retarded.
Where in the hell are contacts? Am I just an idiot and I don't see contacts?
I am an
idiot. Alright, what's this man's connection loyalty? Okay.
I put it all in the chat. In the Roll 20 chat.
You know, it's really great when you don't wait for people to do the things that they're already doing, and then you look like a jackass.
So, as you guys are all sitting there enjoying your soup and complimentary pork buns, is no one going to question the absence of,
Yeah, I'm not going to buy any food.
Well, is no one going to question the absence of the, elf lady?
Elf lady?
What's her name again? Crap.
Oh, yeah!
Oh, we can... Yeah, Coach, where's your character? Is no one going to question the absence of Coach?
I don't know any of these people. Some of them just showed up.
Well, you know that the number of people at this kiosk is not equivalent to the number of people that were in the meeting.
Yeah, you know...
Maybe he's dead.
You know, that's not too bad of an assumption. But, yeah, I guess I'd count the heads.
Wait a minute! You say it while stuffing more soup in your mouth.
Yeah, I'm gonna make a regular perception, and I'm gonna make a matrix perception. Just to stay, because I don't recognize any of your faces. You're off.
If you can forget, dude, if you can forget Psycho Bush, something's wrong with you.
Well, I didn't know he was a Psycho Bush before. I'll never forget that man. I guess I won't be able to tell where anybody is in meat space. But that's because meat space is for scrubs.
Yeah, so do your matrix perception quick. Much better. So you see that these people, their signatures, or their data signatures, are the same. Wait, what the fuck do you call it? Not data signature. Matrix signature?
It would be matrix signature.
Yeah, thank you. These guys are here. But you're actually missing somebody. But when you look around, through like a kiwi green wall, you do see like a faint representation of the fifth person's signature that's not here. And she's... What?
I could do this the fun way. Hack into their systems and turn the anti-grab off. But I feel like that would gain me a little more heat than I really want right now.
You can roll matrix or area knowledge to find out if that's a big deal here.
You could just say ready to go on DNI. That would probably get my attention.
True. But
I'm still not there, am I?
Yeah, you're all there.
You know, I'm not enough of a dick. Not enough of a dick. So I would send her a DNI of. Here, and then I would ping the location.
Okay.
Who has sent everybody in?
Gipa would say she's in the bathroom and she'd be there in 5 minutes. But she will actually leave.
Okay. When you sense everybody, you can tell that everyone at the soup stand is a mundane. Some of which with minor cybernetics. And you do see another astral signature kind of floating around in the gravity bar. Like, inside, you can see it through the wall when your third eye opens. And around you, much like the AR overlay, the astral vision causes so many colors to come at you. Like, you got indigo, you got green, you got blue, you even got some yellows and reds in there. And, make a astral perception test, if that's a thing.
it is.
Would that just be a sensing again?
It would be unless they had...
Sensing is like the next level of astral perception. Sensing, like, astral perception taken. Like, not just perceiving it, but as, like... investigating what you're seeing.
Okay, then yes, make another sensing check.
Well, you actually got that flipped around. Sensing is the lower level. Astral perception is where you actually dip into the astral plane and become dual nature.
Okay, I have not played with many magical people in my time as a GM, so forgive me if I have to double check this stuff. Yes.
Equally, if you're...
You can tell that I'm magical.
Yeah, he saw you. Not a problem. So, throw me another test.
What?
Throw me another ascension. There we go. So, as you look around and you continue scanning and observing people's astral signs, you do see something rather odd. You see, the central area of the mall where you guys are kind of goes on for a while, you know, like a few kilometers down the hall. However, it's kind of dark over there, like the lights have gone out. And then it seems to go pitch black, and closer to you, the lights start to go out. And then that goes pitch black, and then the closer to you, the lights start to go out. And, like, it keeps, like, it'll... The lights are getting out and then going black, and that area, like, you cannot see through the black. So what do you do?
Like thermographic vision is out.
No, you turn on thermographic, you just see like hundreds of people in the mall. And no, like, when you're using thermographic to look through the black, I'm sorry, I misunderstood what you were saying. For you, like, it's nothing. Like, that is an end to all existence, is where the black is.
So there's just a weird wall of blackness?
Yeah, there's not even the cold signature of the rest of the mall.
Seems like something suspicious.
You don't say.
Looking into an astral black hole. First thing you think is, well, that's odd. That's a little out of the ordinary.
So what do you do as the darkness gets closer?
I guess.
Just close your third eye.
Yeah.
Alright, so you do that, and the colors return to normal. And are you still in AR, though?
I'm pretty much always in AR.
Okay, so yeah, you still see the super colorful plastic-looking mall that's in, like, bright candy colors. And all the colors back, all the people are there. No blackness, nothing. Anyway, Coach, you get out to the kiosk where they all are, and you meet them. You're not going to say hello?
I'm sorry,
can you say again? I didn't hear that whole thing.
So, Coach, you leave the gravity bar, and you go out to see these guys sitting at a small table in front of a kiosk on one of the overpasses going through the middle part of the mall.
Oh, okay, so I'll join the rest. Not say much, just, hi, here I am, let's go.
What are you trying to summon?
I want to summon the air spirit and tell it to go investigate that black thing.
Okay. And you got 7 successes, hold on a second.
Also, I would offer to shake JP's hand.
Okay. Hold on, so you do summon the air spirit, and you kind of conjure it up and send it to investigate?
Yeah.
So, the air in front of it kind of ripples as it jumps into the astral plane, but you can still see it, even though they can't. And it goes towards the direction the darkness was, and then disperses into a cloud of fog. And, like, you cannot detect it anymore. Like, its astral signature is just gone.
Another one bites the dust.
My spirit unknowingly just like dove into something that destroyed it.
Hey, you don't know what happened to it.
Yeah, that's true. Equally. It was in agreement.
So now, talk amongst yourselves about what to do.
You have a mental link with it, so.
Yeah, I know. Like, you just cannot see it, feel it. Like, that connection is just gone now.
It should have been able to send me something as it was being destroyed, or if it was being attacked or whatever.
Yeah, that's how you were able to tell that it got cut off. Like, it just went silent. Like, it was. I'm trying to think of, like, how a spirit would communicate.
If I was told to investigate, it should have immediately started a sensing and trying to determine what it was and get it feedback. Like, right off the bat. Instead of not just, like, flying directly into it, just personally.
Oh, I don't know how spirits work. Well, you got a stupid spirit. How's that?
Some of them, you send the service to ask them to do something, and then they fill out or follow your command to the best. So
okay.
Like, go check it out. It should have immediately started trying to determine what it was, like a sensing it or perceiving it. Just like flying right here.
Well, as it suddenly went silent, you do feel very, very ill. Like, you need to go throw up. It's basically like the last thing it could tell you is like, hey, leave. Wow, you guys are fine. You're in meat space.
I think we should get out of here.
The card game.
I'm no longer comfortable staying here. I'm going to stand up and walk away.
What's going on? What's wrong?
Explain yourself to Psycho Bush.
I guess I get up and start following. Probably knock down some chairs, I suppose.
Aww.
I would shake the noodle vendor's hand, and I would slip him an extra, like, 40 New Yen.
Okay. Hold on a second, I need to do something, because...
Go flying everywhere from the game we were playing.
What?
We were playing a card game that we were discussing in chat, and... Over the net, we were sending messages back and forth, and we had decided to play a card game.
Oh, okay, I see it. Okay.
Cards went flying everywhere when we got up from the table.
Okay, yeah, I'm trying to...
They're my cards, but I mean...
I'm trying to navigate 20 windows, give me a break. Okay. So you guys should probably actually get to talking about business now. Oh, you're trying to summon another thing.
Yeah, I guess.
So what do you summon this time? What kind of spirit, I mean?
Just another air spirit.
Alright, so with only two successes, you manage to summon
a
burp.
Actually... Yeah, he did.
You summon a burp.
But I only get two, and he gets three, and then he basically says, no, I don't want to.
Yeah, he's not very happy with you. He knows what happened to the last guy, and is like, oh, fuck this.
Yeah, pretty much.
But he does appear, I will tell you, he does appear, looks around, like, he's visibly terrified.
Basically, they appear for a second, and then, like, you try to fake out and deal with them. So basically, probably appeared and was like, fuck this, sorry.
Yeah, exactly. He just... took one look with his third eye and said, gone!
I'm gonna keep trying, I guess, and I walk away.
Well, you guys should probably focus on talking about the job.
Yeah, I...
Talk away.
I catch up to Jai Kwao, and, I totally just fucking butchered that.
Jay Shao.
Shay Shao,
it's like an SH sound for both.
Right, Shay Shao. Okay. I'd catch up to Shay Shao and kind of like grab him on the shoulder. What's going on back there?
There's something. Some sort of darkness in the astral plane. It consumed one of my spirits. I don't feel safe with that ability.
Keep us posted on that. I want to know if it's following us.
So I'm attempting that. I tried to summon another spirit, and apparently he did not like the situation and left.
Well, if I had a better understanding of what you were talking about, I'd probably be concerned.
Okay, another air spirit. And this is what, spell number 3 you've cast?
Yeah. So just, I'm gonna tell him to,
Yeah, he actually does appear to you, like a gray... It's like a small tornado on the ground, and it grows up, and it kind of looks like, Casper with a long, narrow head. Or actually, picture a freaking, Ghost Freak from Ben 10, that's who appears before you.
You wait a little bit as we walk away, and once we get a certain distance away, I'm going to ask him to pop in to the astral plane to see if this thing is following us or if it's at that location.
Alright, so he nods silently, and as you get farther away, you can see his third eye open, and he looks around, and he sort of like psychically tells you that there's nothing he can see. And he goes over to like the central open area. I assume you guys are walking down one of the halls now. And looks both ways, and you can see him now. Like, the same spot the first guy disappeared. He's floating there. Looks around. Nah, it's clear. Although he does tell you that something kind of bad happened there recently. And he asks you if a toxic mage has passed through here.
If what? If a toxic
what? A toxic mage. Because he picks something up and he doesn't think it's toxic, but it's definitely not normal. Like the residue of some kind of bad mojo.
That means it's got probably either a toxic mage, a blood mage, or an insect mage. All bad.
None of these things.
You say that there's one of them near us?
I mean, one of them was nearby. I'm not sure if they're here any longer.
No, it's gone.
But the presence in here, but like the mage, I guess, could still be hiding, technically. Like, unless he gets someone. I guess there's different. There's different things. It could be someone who creates a darkness around them, or it could be like specifically someone who is casting a spell to affect people in the astral plane. I'm guessing it's the second.
Say, do you dismiss the spirit now?
Yeah, I'll let him go do whatever he wants to do for a while.
Hold on.
Say, well, then in that case. We have nothing more to worry about then.
That's possible, but that roll I just did was to try and remember if there's any like magical data havens that I could throw. I'm so sorry, but I forgot your character's name again. Shushi.
Shishao.
Shishao. God damn it! Okay, I can do this. but if I.
Hey, wait, where's Coach?
That was with us.
You're not in roll 20.
Oh,
I'm writing two separate tablets, so the other one might have went to sleep, sorry.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay, hey, we lost a guy! Okay, continue, I'm sorry.
Yeah, if there's any data havens that I could throw, Xie Xiao's way, you know, get him in contact. I would do that.
Well, there is a shadow net, I guess you could call it, based around Kowloon. There is actually a separate sort of undocumented host in the plaza. So you're essentially standing in meat space, at least, inside of a Matrix host right now. That's, like, there's one that's, you know, an actual host, hosted by the mall, and then one that's, like, a sub-host.
Okay. Well, I would reveal this information to everybody. Before we get started on coming up with a plan, I want to try and get as much information about where we're going, who we're working for, and what the stuff is that we have. So perhaps it would be a good idea to look into this host. While I do that, we can start hashing out the details.
I think we have a job to do, so we should check the heist place first.
I could do that from the Matrix. Xiao, are you able to work your magic literally? Maybe scout it out from here?
Xiao?
Okay. I'm gonna call you Psycho Bush from now on.
It's Deadeye.
Alright, I'm gonna call you Deadeye from now on. Deadeye, you and the others, go check it out. Go check it out in Meat Space. And then we meet. I guess the moonshot. The moonshot's compromised. Let's meet out. The moonshot's compromised. We should meet back up once we have our information. We should meet back up in front of the Mega Mall.
Okay, you, J-Pow, and you, Von Zook, you come with me.
J-Pow says, okay, I'll go with you.
Alright, so the physical team is going to go investigate the store, and the rest of you are going to try and scan the Matrix?
I'm going to scan the Matrix. Shixiao is going to try and do his astral bullshit.
Right, that's what I meant to say. Like, you two are going to stay behind. The rest of you are going to go there physically.
I'm gonna send a message to... Was it Deadeye that said that we're going?
Yes.
I'm going to send a message over comm that says, how about we try some of my drones out for some eyes?
Sounds good. You send your drones then.
Alright, and because you have a rating 2 control rig, I think that means you can control 2 drones at once, right?
4.
Oh, 4, even more badass, okay. Because you have, I think you have 4 flying drones, don't you? You have 2 rotary drones, 2 aerial drones. Okay, I know what it is, but what is a VSTOL drone? Like, I know it's some kind of airborne drone, but what does VSTOL mean?
I know VTOL.
Yeah,
is,
vertical takeoff and landing, but this is VSTOL.
The Lockheed Optic X2.
Vertical short / takeoff.
Oh, okay. So yeah, you have quite a few aerial drones. Which ones are you going to send to check the place out?
I'm actually going to send that one. The Lockheed Optic X2. And the Fly Spy, the MC...
Yes,
yeah.
You have 2 of those, by the way.
And then I'll send both of those. So those three drones.
Those 3? They said 4.
I can do up to 4. Just send them the 3, though.
Oh, yeah, sorry. I misunderstood you when you said that one drone. I thought you were talking about 2 different ones. Okay, yeah.
No, the only reason I'm sending the Lockheed Optic X2 is... I believe that one can go really high, and it's got an amazing optic on it.
Yes, okay. Yep. Took me a minute.
Get amazing, like, aerial, like, way above everything.
Okay. So, I can't remember. You do have to roll aerial piloting, right, for drone checks?
Yes.
Yes, okay, so... Throw me your, whatchamacallit, aerial piloting.
Well, again, I'm doing this from the character sheet, so I can tell you what my rating is.
You can't, roll forward on roll 20?
No, well, yes, I can, but I don't know what I'm rolling. I don't have it all, I don't have my character sheet in roll 20.
Oh. If you go to roll 20, there's like a little dice rolling thing on the left.
It's right under the ruler.
You see it? It's like a d20. Click on that. So like you can enter a number of d6s, and then you can set the value to greater than 5.
Well, that's what I'm saying. I don't know how many I get for a pilot aircraft of 6.
It's that... Well, it's based on reaction, I think, for piloting. So it would be...
7.
So
you add your reaction, which is 7, to your
pilot's rating, which is 6. So then you would be rolling 13 dice.
Yeah, 3 hits. So you need to set it to greater than 5, so it only counts those as hits. Yeah, like that. Okay. But with those, you're able to fly your... fuck. Lockheed. Yeah, you fly your Lockheed up really high above Qui-Fong. Although, remember, you have to stay within the, you can't go above the no-fly zone, or else Ares will shoot you out of the sky.
That one looks like a bird.
Dude, it's... Oh, crap, I forgot, I didn't write that into this. Also, there's an Ares blimp over Hong Kong that acts like an aerial command center.
Okay.
That... I wrote that down in the other mission we're going to be doing Tuesday, because I thought that was going to be the first one. Yeah, oops. There's a giant Ares blimp that maintains, like, an altitude level, and anything that flies higher than it gets shot down.
Even birds?
They can scan your drone and tell it's not a bird.
Gotcha.
Okay, this is, like, Ares' command center.
Ares.
Yeah, I know. Ares are a bunch of assholes, aren't they?
They make good tech. And by tech, I mean guns.
This is true. Alright.
They built my gun.
So, Huli, you sent them a mark, and because it's largely, you know, criminals that kind of ask you who the hell you are.
Basically, just explain to them that I'm one of the local hackers, and as big a message as I can send to them, like a three dimensional box of just I'm not a cop, just like a big party box of just small icons that say I'm not a cop.
You don't have to roll me your persuasion or your negotiation. Anyway, your other two drones are able to get to the store without being detected. I'm a hacker. We need to have Deadeye be the face.
You know? Ooh! That's literally the most successes I could have rolled.
Really? Oh, you only have 2 dice.
-1 negotiation.
Hey, and you got double 6s on 2 dice, so, even though it's not a thing, I'm gonna say that's a crit. And they all kind of like, hey, yeah, it's this guy! And they let you into the Matrix host, or the Shadow host, is what I'm gonna call it, since it's the deep web, pretty much. And inside is
honestly,
basically...
double, or, all... probably worth considering if you got straight 1.
Just letting me in is more than I could ask for.
And the actual hub itself, or the hub, the host itself, is shaped like a the inside of a pagoda, you know, with what do you call it? Wood and paper walls, sort of lining the room, and each room being like a cell. That is like its own holodeck where people can have food, movies, hookers, beer, whatever. And it's all styled after, like...
the Ascensions.
Yeah, it's like... it looks super futuristic if it was designed aesthetically by old Chinese nerds.
Alright. Nice.
There's also, hovering discs that kind of look like straw hats. What did I say?
No, you said it. I was just
meeting. Oh, okay. They look like those hovering straw hats. And you can probably tell that's like their criminal version grid overwatch drone.
Okay.
making sure that the people aren't trying to kill each other.
Right. Well, I mean, if Grid Overwatch is over here, I'm pretty much already fucked, but...
No, it's their Grid Overwatch drones. It's the criminals' drones.
Okay.
But, and as for, Shaoxi, your drones, you know, you do eventually find your way to the...
Shaoxi has drones?
Shay Shao's the mage, not drones.
Sweet sushi, you got your spirit.
I ran out of Pepsi half an hour ago. Hold on.
I know that feeling. That feeling you're feeling right now? I know that feeling.
Vonzook. Your drones get to Kwai Fong Mystical. It's about the size of a pawn shop, but it's a very well-maintained pawn shop with lacquered wood and green-stained doorways with red curtains over the windows.
I'm getting a live feed of this, and I'm going to actually send that feed to everybody in the team.
No, because that screws with the audio, and I don't want to do that. Because when I tested this, if anybody in the stream was watching it while it was going on, it caused a really weird feedback sound, and I hated that. Like, it killed the whole stream.
I was referring to the drones.
Oh, we said, hey, GM, where's the link for the stream?
Oh, that wasn't me.
Anyway, that was Deadeye. Anyway, so...
Gotcha.
I'm
referring to my drones. The drones, I'm going to get that live feed, and I'm going to literally pipe it into everybody.
Oh, okay. So you all see the very nice store, the wood-carved sign that says Kwai Fong Mystical. And you can see just inside the doorway, because there's like a glass window in the door, you know? There are two orcs, just kind of in, you know, jackets and jeans, with their arms crossed, standing near the door. And you can probably infer that they're security. And you can make out a third figure behind the counter, but you might have to roll a perception test to figure out who it actually is.
Which drone is seeing
that? The fly spies are seeing this. The other one, the Lockheed, is like way up in the sky overlooking the store from on top, and I'll tell you what he sees next.
Alright, cool. Can I make that perception check?
Yes.
If I'm watching over the live feed?
Yes, you can. You can all make it to try and figure out who that third thing is.
Do I have penalties or something for it?
No. Just normal perception check. Perception check. Holy Black Jesus, Deadeye! Yeah, so you're able to see that it is another orc man. He's a little bit older than the other guys, and he's in a green polo shirt and brown chinos.
I tell everybody about exactly what clothes he's wearing.
Yep, and he's behind the counter, and the store, when you look through the windows, you can see the store has a bunch of glass-encased shelves and cabinets where they have a bunch of jewelry and other items on display. And behind the counter, there are staves and scrolls and stuff. And of course, under the counter, inside the counter, there are rings and necklaces and whatnot, and there are mannequins wearing robes and capes and masks and so on and so forth. With 5, yes, you can. You can see it is, in fact, on one of the... It's on a mannequin. What?
Nothing.
Say, you see the whole set is on a white mannequin behind the counter standing next to the cork.
Excellent. Alright, well, I will point that out to everybody. I'll, like, zoom it in and I'll say, like, oh, it's there. They're like, where? It's like, it's definitely there.
Even though it's, like, in their heads.
Just pointing at nothing.
Like, this is Deadeye, so it's like on his smartphone, I guess.
He's pointing at his smartphone. It's like, oh, I found it! Deadeye, now is not the time for Flappy Bird. Stop hitting your screen. Okay, so you know what's there, and you know what looks like from the front? The Lockheed, I keep forgetting what it's called, sorry. The Lockheed, looking down from the ceiling, is able to see the, you know, it's made of wood, obviously, the ceiling, or the roof, and it's flat. There's an air vent on top, and also a fireplace chimney. Yeah, like from inside the store. And there's also a ladder going up the back of the store.
Perfect. Okay, so we could jump in through that fireplace. Or somebody who is not me could jump in through the fireplace.
Yes.
I sent a message to everybody. I said, is that everything that we need? In regards to reconnaissance.
Well, Shu Shao wanted to do the astral thing.
Yeah, and I was going to talk to the data haven people.
Oh yes, I forgot. We were also going to get to you. So yes, you could talk to the data haven people. Let's do that right now. What do you ask them?
500 million to the first person who can tell me anything about them, and I would say the name of the place that we're going to.
It's just Kwai Fong, Mystical. You saw it when he had the drones. Oh, and he calls the drones back.
Nice. Right. 500 million to the first person who can tell me anything about Kwai Fong National.
Mystical.
Mystical.
You say Kwai Fong National is a bank. How much million are you offering? Alright. So, not a lot of persuasion is required for that. Darn it. Hold on. I need to get a new box of tissues. My nose has been bleeding for, like, the past 5 minutes.
I'm sorry. I'm just... I have that effect on people.
It's your spirit that got lost in the black hole. It's actually in his nose. Fighting its way out.
I just sneeze and unleash the black death on people. Okay. Yeah, it's not that bad. I'm just, like, wiping away the parts that have, like, stuck inside my nose. The actual bleeding itself stopped. My nose is a toxic shaman. Man, I'm that evil. My nose is a toxic shaman. What are my eyes? So, someone tells you the Kwai Fong Mystical, the first person who talks to you tells you that it is a shop for antique magical objects.
Right.
And they're like dynasty era magical objects. Someone else is also able to tell you that the place is guarded by the Tian Long Protectorate, although is not owned by any of the major corporations.
Okay.
And by the way, are you in Hot Sim or Cold Sim?
Hot Sim.
Okay.
I fucking dare these motherfuckers. I fucking dare them.
What?
I don't know why, but I thought they were about to just start trying to wreck my shit up.
No, I was just wondering, because I've been trying to figure out, like, I haven't looked at it entirely in depth, but, like, what the difference is between Hot Sim and Cold Sim, like, what the benefits are.
The benefit is that in...
reaction.
Yeah, in Hot Sim, you get, you can get up to, You get four dice for Matrix initiative.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, and plus two to all Matrix actions, which I've been forgetting to put.
Okay, no, it's been auto-adding it, I thought. Eh, who cares?
Yeah, because I already clicked the thing.
No problem. I'll just try to remember. Yeah, they're not attacking you. I was just curious because I know there is a difference, and if it became relevant, I wanted to know ahead of time.
Right.
So yeah, it's a public, well, not publicly owned. It's privately owned, public access, does not belong to any corporation. Like, the people inside, like, the people who are usually there at the store are the owner and his two sons who act as security guards. Also, hold on.
I guess we'll loosely call them the spiders.
Who? Okay. And, that store is also very paranoid about feng shui and the maintenance of its, merchandise, because they don't want one of their items, you know, turning evil or something. Yeah, push some chairs over, man, and one of those suits of armor is going to come to life and start murdering people.
Excellent. So we should do that and then just leave and let them murder the guys.
No, I'm joking about that.
I'd rather not resort to violence.
This is Shadowrun. We don't hurt people.
What do you think we are, criminals?
Yeah, I know. Assholes. Do you want more information, or are you good?
Speaking of which, is there some sort of compartments in these blah, 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 blah. Motorcycles
that we have. The motorcycles do arrive while he's in the Matrix, by the way. All of them.
Yeah, I know, but are there, like, compartments or things on there that we could put pieces?
Yeah, like, if you, open the, what do you call it? Not
saddlebags.
What do you call the part? Not the saddle, the seat. If you pull the seat up, there's, like, a hidden compartment under the seat, you know? Oh, easily. Like I said, it's earrings, a necklace, a headband, a choker, six rings, and a jeweled belt. You could probably fit it all in one.
Yeah, okay.
And
split the new unit in half, pay both of them, and if they have anything to say, just reboot.
No one else is coming forward. That's pretty much all the information that's publicly available about this place.
Alright, and I don't have enough money to them for anything more important.
Well, one of them does leave you a link to the website for Kuaifeng. Kuaifeng Mystic, I mean.
I'll take that, and then I'll bid them adieu and thank you, and then I'll get the fuck out of there.
Okay. Although, as you jack out, you do notice something odd. There's a weird delay between your input and you stopping, where your vision sort of goes white and red, a series of thousands of different lines scrolling back and forth horizontally. And what looks like a pair of eyes flashes on the screen for just a nanosecond before you return to meat space.
Hacked. Mm-hmm. Yep. Alright, so I'm going to reboot my deck.
Okay.
Have
you
been able to do anything without also incurring the wrath of something evil in Shadowrun?
It's Shadowrun. That's never, there's
I'm
never a time
I didn't, I'm surprised I wasn't threatened by sentient noodles.
I'm writing that down.
never give the GM ideas, you fool!
Hey, be glad I'm not breaking out the Lothlore blood-based dragon magic virus. I had to break that up for a Prime game I did a while ago because the players got all uppity and I needed a lesson in humiliation.
Yeah, that would have been that's happened in Prime game.
It's like, well,
decent Prime characters and then they could get slapped down pretty hard eventually.
Like, these guys were arrogant. It wasn't that they were acting like they were badasses. They were badasses. It's that they were arrogant about it. Like, they started a fight with a free spirit, or a free dragon spirit that's been alive since the first world. And they thought that was gonna... Well, they didn't know who she was. They just started attacking her for no reason. And she was the Johnson, by the way. And I thought, oh, wow, you guys are fucked. But don't worry, I'm not gonna spring the ancient spirit dragon on you guys.
So do we have a method of entrance?
There's the front door, the chimney, and the vent.
So, J-Pow, you look tiny. You can go through the chimney, right? J-Pow's gone for
Is he not in the Discord?
No, he's in the Discord. He's just not talking.
Huh, his thing probably died on him again. No, things are happening. I don't like it.
J-Pow's dead now.
No.
You have no choice.
Hooli! Hooli! You were gonna do something before we were talking about sentient noodles. You rebooted your deck, and that's fine. You reboot it up. You run your Norton antivirus, and it's queen. It's A-OK. Oh, when you reboot your deck, just so you know, your AR overlay kind of goes off with it, and all the color disappears, and it goes back to marble floors with white stucco everything. And so, like, the flash from color to stark white back to color kind of gives you a minor headache.
This always happens. It's a good thing I've been up for 26 hours straight.
Coffee! Need coffee!
But yeah, as soon as that would come back on, I would send the information I had to everybody.
Including the link?
Yes, just in case anybody wanted to check. And then, I would, I would ask for a mark from everybody again.
Oh, a DNI mark?
Yes.
Slave all our comlinks
to yours
if you've got the strongest defense
matrix
fight. I fucking hope.
Actually, Deadeye here is a computer genius. I don't know if you guys are aware of that.
I'm a Guybert of Fairlight Paladin.
What does the level of the comlink help that at all?
Yeah, it alters how easily hacked it can be, and how much, or how easy it is to interfere with.
So it's either the device rating, or the person you give the mark to.
Yeah, I was gonna say, because I've got a really high device rating online, so...
Meaning it's really hard to hack.
The device rating would only matter if you weren't actually holding the comlink when it got hacked. Like, if you are holding it, then it just goes by your stats. Even if you're not using it. It's really weird.
So it's gonna go by his
firewall here.
Yeah, so if you get hacked without having your comlink slaved to without me slaving your comlink to my deck, it's just going to use your comlink's rating. But if it's slaved to my deck, then
it uses your dex, right?
Yeah, it uses my dex, along with I think some of my skills.
Which is better than what I have?
Immense.
Firewall rating.
Well,
what's the firewall rating? Actually, I guess the better question is, what's your dice?
It would be 11. Actually, it would be 13.
I'm pretty sure mine is 15.
Really?
Maybe I lost my sight. I have a really high willpower with the Hidzaga. But isn't it willpower that the staff that stands for defense?
No, it's almost always logic.
Logic's when you're attacking, when you're defending, it's a different set. I just can't remember.
Power plus firewall. That is true.
Alright, cool. Yeah. That was 15 dice. But my secondary one's got a little advisor.
Alright.
As you guys are sitting at like a small kiosk outside Starbucks working on this, Orc in a black trench coat does approach you. And he kind of goes up to the guy sitting on his deck, you know, clearly a nerd. And he leans over to the dwarf, and he says, "Hey, any of you guys up for Asia?"
I'm going to stick my Irish Predator 5 in his gut and say, "Get away from me right now."
Oh, okay. I can put up his hands and steps back. Like, hey, okay.
Get out of here. I'm going to put it back.
Actually,
I'm going to keep it trained on him until he leaves my line of sight.
Yeah, he like backs up and sort of turns down the hallway.
We should do it now.
Although, make a palming check to make sure nobody sees you pull a gun in public.
Make a what check again?
Palming.
Yeah.
What?
Oh no.
Uh-oh.
Why are you even trying things with an agility like that?
Because again, this was supposed to be like, if everything went belly up, that's when I would use this gun.
He just wanted to sell you some drugs.
Pull it out from somebody just trying to sell you your drugs.
Well, I didn't.
So like those drugs.
Go belly up.
Hey, man! First, it's hey, you wanna buy some drugs, and then bam, switchblade right in your throat. Everyone is an enemy, all the time.
I'm pretty sure I'd move faster.
Rocks move faster than me.
All right. Well, the crowd around you doesn't immediately react to you holding a gun in public. Although they don't really look at you, they kind of just avoid you at all cost. And they leave you and your little group to deck there.
I'm still far away from him, away. Right?
I said you guys are all sitting outside the Starbucks right now.
Yeah, we should go now.
I thought I was with the Jedi far away. Yeah, so we're
going to get out of here right very second, guys.
Wait, what happened?
Yeah, you guys have my contact information.
Yeah, go home.
Alright.
I got
stuff.
Yeah, I should really also turn in.
You go.
Alright, so. So you guys are all.
If you get caught by the police, you never knew.
I would hope that's what everyone would say.
So you were doing what again? Before the drug dealer showed up? Okay, you got a DNI from everybody.
Right, and it occurred to me that I'd be in hot sim, so I'd be basically a passed out body just kind of laying around.
Yeah.
In hot sim, you can't interact with the world around you.
Oh. Deal. Well,
because hot sim.
I mean, what was that orc even thinking?
Yeah, I just forgot that. That's a thing in hot sim. You know, since it takes over all of your senses, you're basically just a passed out body on the side of the road.
Which is exactly why you need to stop hallucinating everything that just happened, because there is currently an orc drug dealer trying to sell Asia to the rest of the team, who is still sitting with you.
Asia,
roll me a street drug knowledge check if any of you have it. Or are you just asking the guy?
Yeah, I'm gonna ask him.
Alright. So he hands you like a little pill package, like, you know, those plastic sheets of pills. He holds up one of those and he says, "You see, bud, what you do is you peel the stuff off, like you peel the wax seal off, and then you get like the edge of like a pen or a card or something small. You fish it out, and then you lick it off like a lollipop, and then it gets you high as a kite, man. Like, you're gonna see, you can see sound, and you can taste colors, and you can hear the unhearable side of things, man."
I'll stick to my sight thing.
"No, thank you, sir. I'm high on life."
We need Deadeye in more games.
We need Deadeye in every game.
He's my secondary character.
He's on anymore.
So the guy just nods. He kind of leans in to Deadeye and says, "Hey man, I really need your help. If I don't get 500 new yen back to my boss, they're gonna cut my fucking hands off." Well, he's doing the bargaining, so what you need to do is you need to roll me what is it to resist bargaining? It's not composure, it's there is a composure. I think it is composure then. Okay.
Can I judge intentions?
Sure, if you want.
It's the same as that. It's not like the composure check.
It's gonna be fine.
I mean, technically if you're resisting negotiation, it is a negotiation role from yourself as well.
Oh, okay.
Rules is written.
Deadeye. You can tell this guy is not joking. He's going to lose his hands if he does not bring you back 500 new yen.
So he's asking Deadeye.
Is that 250 new yen a hand?
Yeah, who's he that? Who's he asking?
Deadeye.
I give him all of my remaining new yen.
And how much do you have?
255. I'll say it's all I can spare.
And he says, "Oh, thank you, man. You really saved my ass. Do any of your friends have anything?"
I will look at them and expect them to do something. I'll say, it's a man's hands. It's important.
What do you have on you that's worth 250?
I have a bunch of this Asia. Like he's feeling through his pockets. I have a gold-plated pocket knife, a silver Zippo lighter. It ain't worth much, but I have an old leather watch.
I'm gonna send a message over, AR, so I guess I'll just start typing on my smartphone.
Okay.
And I'll start telling guys that maybe we could use him as, like, maybe a distraction for a job or something.
Something.
Yeah.
I'll pay him the other 250 if he allows me to let one of my spirits use his body for a day.
Whoa.
For what purpose?
Whatever purpose I want.
Sexual pleasure.
Hey,
no,
man,
it would most likely be so that the spirit can just, like, enjoy the material plane for a day.
Oh, no.
So, I don't really know what he's
sex, drugs. You're pouring them out to a spirit.
Food. Probably all three of those are going to be involved.
You're going to have to roll a negotiation for that.
This could get very expensive very quickly.
He may lose his hands anyway.
Alright, two successes versus his
86 dice.
No, he kind of shakes and he says, I guess, sure, when does your spirit need me? I'll be back here.
I'll give you the money now, as long as you give me your contact information. And I'm going to also assist him in judge intentions while he's giving me his contact information.
Alright, so like he writes down like a pen, Peter Wong, on a piece of paper and hands it to you and his comlink number, so you can call him.
Tell me.
Wow! You can tell he's being honest, and he is scared shitless of people cutting off his hands, and probably other things that he hasn't talked about.
Cool, so I'll give him 250 new, and I'm gonna tell my spirit to follow him.
Okay. And this is the same spirit from before?
Yeah.
Okay.
Please tell me you have some Bouchagawawa music ready for this.
Yeah, I have some what?
It's not gonna take him yet. It's just gonna make sure it knows its house. So
alright.
This is weird.
What?
Trust me, this is not nearly.
My spirits don't really interact with the material world unless they're possessing something. Otherwise, they have to say astral.
Well, Deadeye. So, Deadeye. Because you're a kind person, you do get two karma. Shao Shao, you're an asshole. You get nothing. Your spirit has a body. That's payment enough.
Shao Shao is so much of an asshole. You guys have no idea how much of an asshole Shao Shao is. He actually was considering possessing the guy instantly and just sending him back to kill the guys who had threatened to cut off.
Anyway, so you can tell like when your spirit follows him that he actually goes to a nearby bar a few blocks away, and he like the guards or the doormen recognize him, let him through, and then some suited men let him into a back room where he meets with someone, and it's a little hard to tell who, but they're going back and forth, and he gives this guy at the table the money, and the man in the suit says, "Very good, now get out of my bar and never come back." Right. And then he goes to his like apartment complex a few kilometers away.
Nice.
Where he then hugs his... Like he hugs his child,
location.
And then sleeps with his wife, and he's happy. And, that's everything you guys wanted to do, right? Or is there more?
Yeah, I just go home and,
start
working on some spirit crap.
Go to sleep.
Okay, do all of you just go to sleep?
Well,
hell no.
How?
What?
I'm not sleeping for the next 24 hours.
And what's the time?
In game, it's like 9 o'clock.
So, by the time I get to Whampoa...
It'd be about... Like, well, on your motorcycle, it'd be about 9:30.
I guess. So, yeah, I'll stop by the pawn shop and harass the pawn shop a bit longer. Just telling them about my cool day. And looking at his stuff.
Okay, he's just like...
Whenever,
he's repairing something and going like... Oh, goddammit, Deadeye. It's like, Deadeye, don't knock over the suit of armor. And then, you know, you shoulder bump the suit of armor in order to get to the shiny thing beside it. And you're like, hey, I found a pocket watch. He's like, goddammit, Deadeye.
Yeah, that sounds about right.
It's like that fucking psychotic bush.
And I'll go to the coffin motel that I sleep, and I will sleep there.
Okay. We find a cheap van. You have a pickup truck, Von Zook. You can just carry your drones in that. Yeah, Rover Model 2072. It's an SUV. Which I'd imagine has a lot of space for drones. I think that's made Von Zook's day. What are you trying to summon now, Shishao?
Another air spirit.
Another one?
Yeah.
Okay.
The man's consistent. It's
not just the same. Consistent.
Okay, so what are you trying to summon this one for? I think this is your last air spirit. No, I mean, like, before he can suffer, or before he has to suffer drain. I thought this was your 6th. Actually, no, it's your 5th.
I summoned one that got destroyed right away. I was unable to summon another one, and this is the 3rd one. And the last one's the 3rd one. This would be my 4th
one. Oh, yeah, because you didn't dispel him. So this is only your 4th one. Okay. Right. And what is his job?
Nothing right now. Just to wait around until I have something to
do. chill here, Spirit.
His job is to diddle that
one. I mean,
one.
He can go do whatever he wants. Have him around for now. I summon a not special. Actually, you know what? I think I'm going to use Edge on while I summon that Spirit to get more successes.
I don't know, man. A Force 9 spirit's pretty powerful.
Yeah, I only got 2 net successes. So even with the Shaman Tuxedo, that's only 3 services from the spirit. And even if I bind it and get some additional services, it's not very many. So
okay.
I edge to get some additional services.
Who the hell is playing that music?
That's what's going on in the background. Spirits.
Oh. Please don't do that.
One I'm not specialized in. Which means it's going to be... I gotta figure out what it is. Fires for health. Combat for guardian.
Yeah, Spirit of Fire is the next one.
Hold on a second, I'm looking at something. Hold on a second, I need to look for something. I got up and I finagled the Faloofy. I'm
always gotta finagle the Fallopian.
Mm-hmm. I tell you, ask my girlfriend, I can finagle Fallopians all night long.
Whoa. I really don't know where this went, but I'm kinda worried.
I said Faloopy, I don't know how you got Fallopian.
Really shouldn't be a point of, like, pride that you finagle
Fallopians. What? I'm a doctor!
No.
Now I guess I'm gonna take the time.
I'm trying to find something in the book.
What are you looking for?
Glitches.
Glitches for spirit summoning?
Well, like, any action can glitch if it's more ones than... If it's as many ones as there are successes, right?
More ones.
More, it's gotta be over here.
It's,
Oh, yeah, so I'm gonna also ask, my spirit to put guard on me so that critical glitch gets set up.
So if it's as many ones as you got successes, it's not a glitch?
No, it's over half your dice that you rolled total are ones, then it's a glitch. And if there are hits of the same thing...
Then it's a critical glitch. Oh, okay, I thought it had to be like the number of ones was greater than the number of successes. I'm not sure what the spirit thinks of you.
Nice. Okay, cool. Going down to the binding. Once I get an additional four successes on it.
I mean, it's very possible.
That's the last thing I don't have to do. I don't actually have to do drain for. So for that one, I actually have to start with the drain, I guess.
And what kind of spirit did you summon?
That's a fire spirit.
Okay.
That last one was binding fire spirit. And now
fire spirits. Whoa!
Time to spend to just fail at it. But honestly, if I'm gonna save edge so that we have it for whatever we're doing, I think that's probably the smartest attack here.
Well, remember, you get a point of edge back whenever you rest.
Yeah. Nah, I'd just rather put in more time, unfortunately.
Okay.
Actually,
so what are you doing? More time or what? Because they're all going to sleep.
Well, actually, I'd stay up in A. I'd A, request a mark on that place that we're going to. And once I've done that, I'll probably spend the rest of my time just playing Matrix games.
Right. Now, when you say mark, do you mean like going into the grid where the store is listed?
Yeah.
Oh, you can just go in there. You don't have to get a mark. It's open grid.
Well, yeah, I don't have to get a mark on the grid, but you can request a mark on a host, which presumably this shop would have a host.
Oh, okay. Yes.
So probably... So how many days are we waiting before we actually do this?
Like, well, it needs to be done in the next three... Well, today's... It's Sunday night now in-game. You have until Wednesday this week, which gives you 8 days.
Okay. We should definitely probably do it no later than Tuesday.
So wait, did you people seriously...
...deal with situations like this? Chip runs out.
Are we spending Monday just, like, watching the area? Like, casing the joint? And just do it Tuesday.
I love how none of you guys caught what I said about 8 days.
Sorry?
Yeah, no, I
yeah, was it one whole week, or is that a 3 day? Is the month over?
I was joking. Yeah, it's only 3 days.
Okay. Right, I noticed it. I just had to point out that we only have 5 days.
Yeah. Alright, so that's basically till Monday evening, and then, yeah, I'll sleep for just, you know, a cycle, 8 hours, and then do one more summon and binding, and then whip up alchemy, and then it's like Tuesday afternoon-ish. Tuesday.
So you're gonna rob the place on Tuesday, but case it on Monday? Okay. So you have your spirits. Huli, sorry, I've been ignoring you. You request the mark to the store. And he gives you access to the general site, but that's about it. So it's like you can walk around a digital representation of the store, and all of the items have like floating information boxes next to them. And you can select which ones you want to buy because you can see the prices and how old they are and whatnot. However, it's really not that different from walking around the store in AR.
I have no money.
Well, the cheapest thing in there is 300 million New Yen.
Okay. Wow.
For a pair of shoes.
Oh, right.
Well, hey, if you read the thing, the shoes actually make it to where, like, you can look at someone or something and run, and you will always run just fast enough to catch up to it.
Alright, well, I am gonna real quick just, I'm gonna ask for two more marks.
None.
On what?
On the host.
If you have to bolt, you know, don't you?
You can. You can ask nicely for a mark.
Oh, just ask for it.
Yeah, I mean, you can. And they'll usually give you the first one, because, you know, that lets you in the door. But any more lets you do the stuff that people like us would want to do. So generally, they'd say no, and that's when I have to do either brute force or hack on the fly. So I'm just going to ask them, hey, can I have more marks? Please and thanks.
The guy said, like, did you have trouble getting in the first one?
No.
Well, why do you want two more if you're already in?
Busted. When?
Well, if you already got in, why do you need the other two? It's still Saturday or Sunday night, and Huli is going to hack the fuck out of this old man's store.
Hack that shit. Hacking plus
yes. So I'm unavailable to you guys until like Tuesday noon. Respond to messages occasionally, but for the most part, I'm like,
wait, what are you doing?
Just that's how long it takes me to do all the summoning, finding, and sleeping.
Oh, okay, that's what you're saying.
Yeah. I just added up all the hours and didn't have it until Tuesday at noon.
Alright, let me roll for the thing security. Okay. So, Huli, as you try to get into the system's firewall, you actually notice something. It is so colossally old and, like, broken. It's, like, only 27 lines of code.
Beautiful.
All right. So, it's like, you can just knock on it, say, hey, what's that, and then walk on by. And this, you have to remember, this store was founded in, like, it was built in, like, the 2030s, so. And it's had the same owner since.
Right.
Like, you know, this orc is very old.
This is going to make my life, everyone's life, really, a lot easier. Where's spoof command? Here we are, hacking plus intuition. Alright, so I'm going to spoof a command. And basically, just put into the files that all of that stuff is supposed to go to Deadeye.
All of what stuff?
All the MacGuffin stuff.
Do you remember what the MacGuffin stuff is?
Can I roll a memory?
Roll a memory!
I mean, it was in the Matrix, so it's pretty easily recorded. You guys have any go sim rigs?
So yes,
I'm in a sim rig right now.
I do not.
So, Huli, you remember that you needed to find the Empress's favor set of jewelry, which is 2 earrings, a necklace, a headband, a choker, 6 rings, and a jeweled belt.
Alright.
Record that shit so you don't forget.
Okay.
So, you're gonna try and plant a file to, like, sell it, or to make it, Deadeye's?
Yeah, so basically when he comes in, they'll check the files and it says all of that stuff goes to him.
Okay, are you gonna roll for your spoofing?
Yes. And swiggity swag.
Alright, nice. Also roll your Matrix perception.
Techno critter live in there. And
yeah, guy's a fucking technomancer.
He just trapped a fucking techno critter in there.
Alright, what am I looking at here?
Nothing. You just find the files. And now that you find them, you can actually spoof them. And so you go in, I assume you edit them, make it to where it's like, pay to the order of this guy. Are you still doing this in the mall?
You marked down basically the iterate page.
No, I've already gone back home because I remember that being outside at all ever is the worst idea possible.
And where are you currently? Like a coffin hotel or something?
I actually have my own apartment.
Oh, cool. Where?
It's, it would be nearby. It'd be to the northeast of...
You're currently in Quai Fong.
What section is the Whampoa area? Is it actually named Whampoa?
Yeah, it's in Whampoa Gardens. That's the name of the area. The Whampoa is the boat that the place is named after.
Is Whampoa Gardens like an apartment complex or something?
To my understanding, it's a series of towers that are both, like, business towers and apartment towers, and on top of those towers are gardens. Like, hanging gardens and stuff.
Yeah, I definitely live in there. I live in an area rating 5 area, so I probably live
in there. Okay. And you, what is the rating of your area, Huli?
I think it's, 2.
And that's low, right?
Yes.
Okay. Anyway, so you edit the files, and how do you edit the files?
So I would basically gain system admin level of stuff, of access, and just change the registry so that whatever it was before...
Well, it's not been purchased by anybody.
Okay, then it would say that it's that the money's already been sent through. Everything checks out the way it needs to and basically the items are to be given to a person by the name of Deadeye.
All right. So roll another Matrix perception.
All right.
Man, you and your...
Consistent.
You and your threes.
If nothing else, I am consistent.
Alright, so nothing comes up, and as you edit the files, when it says pay to the order of, and it comes up as Wu Chang.
Okay.
Like, you're typing Deadeye, but it's coming up as Wu Chang.
Specific file.
Well, are you,
for the next, like, couple days.
Well, are you going to continue editing it? Because, I mean, you said pay to the order of, but you haven't altered the actual ledger information at all.
Oh, well, I would send it.
See, you'd have to make a spoof on the ledger to make it look like the item has been paid for. Because currently it looks like it's been reserved for this guy, but it has not been paid for yet.
Okay, yeah, that's what I've been meaning to do this whole time. So do you need me to do another spoof?
Yes. Because it's the... I'm trying to what the two terms are. Because it's two different things. It's like the buy order and the book, the document keeping of it. Alright? So you go through...
Got a ledger to make.
Ledger, thank you.
Sales.
Yeah, you're...
It's not like it's like a target-sized business. It's like a small business run by a guy who's probably going to notice if there's something just, like, sold randomly that nobody paid for. What the fuck?
Yeah, see, so you had to make...
Check the ledger, and it looks like it's sold.
Yeah, you had to feign the buy order and feign the ledger.
Yeah, that's what I've been trying to do.
Okay.
I just haven't been using the right terminology.
I think, well, I know what you've been meaning to do, which is that you had to do it twice, is all. And roll me another matrix perception.
Okay, but after this perception, I'm going to change out one of my programs for baby monitor.
And what does that do again? I'm trying to remember.
It tells me my Overwatch score.
Oh, okay. Alright, so you type in, you know, pay to the order of Deadeye and whatnot. However, when you say pay to the order of Deadeye, and you insert the amount that the set costs, which is, 15 million. I'm sorry, 150 million is how much it costs. You know, you have to put it in there, and I'm guessing you, like, do you enter, like, a fake bank account, or do you link it to a bank account, or that actually exists? You just enter, like, a fake made-up code.
Yes. Whatever will work.
Well, what are you going to enter? Like, just type in random numbers and letters and say, oh, that's the bank account code?
If you're a decent decker, you probably have, like, a fake bank account kind of set up. Actually, if you're a Shadowrun decker already, you're used to running the streets.
That's true.
If you're new to the streets, you probably don't have anything like that set up.
No, this something similar to this is stuff that I would have done before. So,
I mean, you know, you run. Basically, he could check, you know, follow up on the bank. If it's really just a shop run by one dude, he knows everything that's supposed to be sold. He knows this isn't supposed to go to you. And he might like really thoroughly follow up.
That's true. So then, yeah, I would use an actual bank account. I'll use my actual bank account that I have set up. No.
Hey, you better be ready to burn that bank.
I was gonna say that is remarkably stupid.
Ready to burn that motherfucker.
Yeah, that's
sins.
I don't have a sin.
Oh, wow.
I couldn't afford it. I'll call up. I'll call up Lang again and see if he has anything set up, because more than likely, even though I would have done this before, chances are those other bank accounts that I would have had, I probably also have burned already. So, and even if that's true for me, Lang's my go-to guy. I would imagine that he would be able to scare me up some stuff since I'm completely out of money right now.
Alright. So, you shoot him a text over a VR, and he sends back to you a compressed file, and okay. When you open it, you find, like, a list of dead people's bank accounts.
Swig. Alrighty then.
And maybe, just maybe, if you combine all 250 accounts in that email, you might be able to pay off half of how much that set is supposed to fucking cost. In semi-legitimate ways.
See, all I need to do is make this guy think that he's got... Okay. Do I see any other matrix signatures in that area?
In what area?
In the host, or in the area of the host.
Make a matrix perception. Oh, wait, you did. Or is that your old one?
That's my old one.
Okay. Damn, you and your threes, homie!
Jeez. Beautiful!
Is it possible for you to edit one file? To make it look like you received payment and edit another file to make it look like it.
That's what I choose! God damn. Wait, no, that's why I did this to perception, because I was going to find the guy's comm link or whatever he's using.
What guy's?
He's using as a ledger and then edit that to say that he's already got the payment.
Oh, he has like a dinosaur Alienware laptop. Yeah, you can see up where he keeps his records on it.
Alright, now is he...
You're gonna make a fake payment, like with fake money. You probably want to do it, like, very shortly before actually going to buy. Because eventually, if he doesn't update, it'll come up as fake.
Okay. So I'm gonna check the baby monitor real quick. Do I have an Overwatch score?
No, you are straight zero.
Alright, then I'll just send a quick DNI to everybody. That was my plan. Everybody just get ready.
Alright, and...
Good plan, assuming he doesn't already know who the fire is supposed to be
affected. So wait, when you do the ledger, hold on, and you're writing up like the fake bank accounts and who owns the account, again, you enter Deadeye's name, but no matter what keys you press... It will always come up as Wu Chang.
Is that your real name?
No, obviously someone, right? Obviously someone's in my deck. Fucking.
I mean, can't you just reset your deck and it takes all the marks off of it?
That's the thing, I already did that earlier.
And he doesn't have a grid Overwatch score.
Grid Overwatch score is different than someone actually having one.
I know.
Having marks on your deck is what has to be done for someone that, like, fuck with you.
Yes.
And I would know.
So, can you do, like, a general, what would you call that? I want to say technical perception or mechanical perception. What do you call it for analyzing a deck?
Do you have the diagnostics app?
Diagnostics, yeah.
It's such a program. Super cheap, it's like 50 million. You can just go
go by it, probably.
And you're in hot sim, I'm guessing?
I am in hot sim, but okay. I don't have 50 new yen.
You don't have 50 new yen?
No, I have, at the moment, I have zero.
Well, do you have to pay to use the,
There's, it's between zero and 50 new yen, so I guess it depends probably on your lifestyle.
Wait, for what, the diagnostics?
Yeah, it's just it's a sliding scale. Probably it really is how much you pay depends on how good the diagnostics program is. It doesn't actually get a reading, it's just a median cost between 0 and 50.
Can't he manually try and do a manual diagnosis himself? Analyze it himself. Yes, thank you.
That would be with a matrix perception, but that would just be to see if I have marks on me.
Okay, we'll do another one then.
Nope. Yeah, because I'm not seeing those diagnostics in the data trails.
See, I don't think there's a diagnostic skill.
Damn it! The one time I really needed it to not do that.
You go into the, I guess you could say, hard wiring of your deck, and because you did this, I assume you had to check out.
No.
You can do it inside.
This is basically just I look at myself and do I have any marks? Because when you get a mark on someone, you literally place a in the matrix physical mark on them.
Okay.
It would be an icon.
Yeah, diagnostic.
Oh, that is exactly what I thought was going on here.
Evaluation system that monitors all devices and user hand giving constant live statistics on their behavior. They're also popular keeping people aware of attacks in a manner similar to a biomonitor.
Alright.
So page 56 of damage.
So you look around and you actually do notice something strange. It's pretty obvious actually.
Okay.
Because you see like a small orb and it's gold. But when you actually look at it directly, the screen of red and white lines appears and the eyes flash again, and you are just forced out of the matrix and have to suffer dump shock.
That motherfucker, he doubled. His fucking number. Alright, okay.
You have to roll for dump shock now.
Alright. Okay. What is that? It's been a while since I've had to look at dump shock.
So I'm looking for it right now. Like, oh fuck, where'd it go?
It's very possible that this could kill me. Damage value for Dump Shock is 6s if you're in cold sim, 6p if you're in hot sim.
And you're in hot sim.
Yeah. And since I'm running virtual machine, I actually take an extra 3 boxes of damage.
Damn, if you were willing to pay some money, I could start selling you some alchemical stuff that'll raise your willpower by 4.
Well, I don't have any money, so. It's a moot point!
Roll to resist your dump shock, buddy. Because can't you roll to resist it?
Maybe.
Willpower plus fire.
We get together.
Right.
Did I seriously set my fire on top? I did. Alright. I take 7. 7 physical.
So yeah, your head starts burning, your eyes like get blurry, you get a nosebleed, there's like a burning pain shooting throughout your body as you just lurch backwards onto the floor of your apartment room, or hotel room, or apartment, yes.
Yeah.
But you're still alive, right?
Yeah, I'm just really fucked up.
Alright, so because the ringing is drowning out everything, you can focus on the image burned into your eyeballs. And, what all knowledge skills do you have? I'm navigating too many tabs to check right now.
Well, this is very concerning that you need to know that, but, Cantonese, area knowledge, Hong Kong, organized crime, Hong Kong, data havens, cyber technology, gaming, and bars and clubs.
If you really stretch it, I guess you could roll area knowledge for what you need to find out.
Okay.
So yeah, area knowledge. So, the thing kind of burned into your retinas right now. It's the only clear thing in the blurry area around you. It looks like, hold on a second. It looks like a little pentagram where the eyes that were blinking at you, that appeared for just a second, their pupils are a pentagram with the 5 points, earth, metal, air, water, fire.
Okay. Alright.
And it takes like a minute or two, but you know, the ringing fades, your vision returns to normal, and the burned image goes away. But your head still really fucking hurts.
Alright, well, I'm gonna call Zhu Zhao, like actual call, with my comm link.
Who?
Zhu Zhao!
Listen, I'm pretty sure those orbs that the Johnson gave us, he's watching us with it.
Wait, who's watching us?
The Johnson. Mr. Wu.
How is he watching us? Those orbs on our complex.
Yes, it's attached to whatever we use to get on the Matrix with.
No. I don't give a fuck, that's my other comlink.
But...
Oh, it's bad for you guys.
It's bad for all of us, because if he's watching us, what's he watching us for? Mm. If we're supposed to be doing a job for him... Exactly, the job's gotta... It's gotta be compromised.
Can you make a... regular perception test, Lumi?
You're asking a lot. You're asking a lot here.
I know.
Okay, roll this. I think it should take off. Worth saying.
Alright, so you look out the windows of your apartment, just kind of like looking around, I guess, and you notice rain and the hustle and bustle of cars going in and out of the parking lot. So, continue talking to Xie Xiao.
That Deadeye bought the thing. what the stuff. But I couldn't change the name to Deadeye. It kept changing the name to something else. And when I tried to check myself out of it, the Matrix, he dump shocked me.
You might want to make another regular perception test. Okay. Keep talking.
Solid eyes, where are you? I'm gonna come put a clean spell on. Sound fucked up.
You what?
I'd recite my address.
Oh, okay.
Oh, fuck. You know what? I'm fucked anyway. Alright.
I'm in. I'll take a taxi. I don't trust the motorcycle breaker.
Yeah, Von Zug, I think he realized what he did.
I'll leave the second call. Copy of my contact information to it just so that I have it. I really don't like it.
Okay, make another perception test, Huli.
Alright. Now, I would like to declare right now that the entire time I have been holding my Predator 5.
I imagine.
Yes! Yes!
I imagine it was in your pocket the whole time. Although, you have as many ones as you do successes.
Right.
Oh yeah, that's not a glitch, never mind. Get right on. So, you hear what sounds like metal creaking from your window? Or, not from your window, but like from the sliding glass door going out of your apartment to the balcony. And judging by its location, it's your fire escape that's creaking.
Predator and take my flashlight out and shine it over there.
Alright. So keep talking to Shishao.
Well,
why aren't you? Well, I think I'm still on the phone with you, but you would have been like looking away from the voice call or face call or whatever. I'd be like, what the fuck? Why aren't you paying attention to this call?
Someone's in here.
Alright, now make another perception check.
Also, I'm sorry everybody else for, like, kind of hijacking this.
Oh no, this is cool.
Fuck!
Oh, you have no success. Actually, but you don't have any ones. I really want someone to get a glitch just so I can be evil. So you hear, like...
It's not enough, you bloodthirsty heathen.
You hear, like, a loud metal bang. But you're not sure what direction it came from other than in front of you. So it could have come from your fire escape. It could have come from one of the other fire escapes. And not to mention, your door is to the left of the sliding glass window.
Okay, I'm going to push myself as best I can up against,
the back right corner of the room.
Yes, and, I'm going to keep moving between both, between both locations so that somebody could be coming in, shining my flashlight the whole time. Got that. Got it in my mouth.
Okay, and Shay Shao, since you're on the phone, what do you have to say to, like, him acting like an idiot?
I guess if he says somebody's coming in, I'm just gonna, like, kind of facepalm for a second, like, as much as, like, hand my gas mask. And then, say, fine, I'm gonna send over a couple of spirits. Air spirit, guardian spirit.
I owe you one.
Definitely do. Service costs a lot.
Alright, so.
A lot out of here.
make one more perception check.
This is some bullshit. Some bullshit, like just a toy monkey. Would be pissed.
Oh!
Yes!
Alright, so you hear a loud metallic clicking sound coming from the other side of your doorway.
Alright. You know what? Fuck it, I'll shoot.
Gonna shoot at the door?
I'm gonna shoot at the door.
Okay. And by the way, did the guys tell you how the shooting house rules worked here?
There are shooting house rules?
Just with damage, don't worry. The shooting itself is done the same way, though.
Oh, okay. I was like, this is not stuff you spring on me at this point! I am dick deep in getting murdered, and this is not the time to tell me there are extra rules!
By the way, you didn't know you had a grenade in the counter? No, remember, did the guys tell you how armor functioned?
Yes.
Okay, good. That's what I was talking about. So, you fire at the doorway, and you, how many times do you want to shoot? Because it's, what, semi-automatic?
Yeah. Single shot. I don't have the strength or the constitution to fire more than one shot at a time right now. But wait a minute. It didn't bring in that I had a smart link.
Oh, it didn't?
You gotta set that up on your equipment. Some say it's not perfect, the character sheet transfer.
Yeah, it's not perfect. I'll go ahead and re-roll and add the smart link. Because I'm a merciful GM, right?
Sorry, what? That was...
Because I am a kind and merciful GM, right?
Absolutely, says the murdered character.
Hey, no one's been murdered yet.
Wait, I just got back. What happened? Somebody died?
Almost. I'm like 3 seconds from it.
That sucks.
It's my own fault for over specializing.
What kind of weapons do you guys use, right? Are you all shooters? Except guns.
Well, I was I built myself from the ground up just to be a hacker. So I have an Ares Predator 5 and that's it.
I don't even know
if those guys
have a taser.
So do you have the smart link set up?
I'm trying to find the rules for smart link. Fucking where the hell is it? How would it be with firearms? Am I just an incompetent fool?
I think it's actually in the cyberware section, or in the visual augmentation section. It's like a +2, I think, to rolls.
Okay. That's what the hell I need right now.
Yeah, 2 extra dice if you have a smart link equipped. And actually, I think it's... Is it just... Do you have smart link in your eyes, too?
I have goggles.
Because I think if it's... If you have a smart link in your goggles, it's +2. If you have a smart link in your goggles and a smart link attached gun, it's +2 more, I think.
Oh, I got rid of the goggles. Okay, so I guess I just have the smart link.
Well, do you have it cybernetically enhanced? Or are you cybernetically enhanced with the smart link?
I didn't have an appointment.
Then I'm afraid you don't have smart link, because you need to have, like, an actual visual component to it.
You know, I was gonna buy a monocle, but I said, oh no! Oh no! need a monocle. Yeah.
I mean, if you're not magical, she just got contact with the smart.
I've never seen a person so happy in this game. And so that's your first shot. How many are you gonna fire?
Just.
Okay, so they fire through the door, and as your gun starts ringing, a burst of fire comes back through at you. Roll your dodge.
I mean, you want to know what my dodge is, but nobody else wants to know what my dodge is.
This is my reaction to redemption.
Oh!
Oh, wow. So, you actually managed to, like, push yourself off of the kitchen counter to the other side of the kitchen as the burst of bullets comes through, and it misses you entirely. So now your turn to shoot.
Okay, I would also scream into the comlink, "They're here right now!"
And now that you're in combat, you have two actions, and you know the drill.
Yeah. Right.
You scream into the comlink? So to,
Shish out.
Okay, cool. I'm gonna go back to some.
Imagine for a second.
No, if you could manage you just, to like, contact shoot us, we might be able to make it there.
No. Let him do it. I'm gonna go back to sleep.
I just imagine you like shoot up in bed for 5 seconds, and then you're like, "It's been a dream."
That's exactly what happens.
Right. I'm going to take aim, and then fire.
Okay.
Fire one shot. That's what I'm talking about.
I should add there's no masturbation allowed on this podcast.
Too bad. It's already happening. It's far too late.
And aiming was an action, right?
Yeah, aiming is a simple action, and then taking a single shot is also a simple action.
Okay.
Also, up to, up to three shots. You can't do a three-shot burst as a simple action.
I know. Alright, now, his turn. Another, like, burst volley of rounds comes through the wooden door. So, roll for dodge again.
Alright, if I don't get a good roll, I'm gonna end roll it.
I think they can travel through the astral plane, like, insanely fast.
Alright, so...
That's four hits.
Well, luckily, the bullet does hit your arm, but at such an angle to where it tears the sleeve of your jacket, and the other kind of goes right by your ear, puts, like, a small crescent-shaped gap in the very edge of your cartilage. And the last one just, like, wings your underarm. Like, you barely were able to dodge. It was a glancing hit.
I'm gonna take aim and fire again.
We should call this episode "Hooey by the Skin of His Teeth."
Oh my god. Come on. Yes, I glitched, didn't I?
Someone glitched. But it weren't you.
Oh, yes.
So, you managed to fire a bullet through the hole in the door, right? It goes up the barrel of his gun as he tries to fire back, and it explodes in his hands. And, like, metal bits kind of go to his arm and his chest, and you hear him scream, and then he starts, like, running away. To get away from the apartment, back into the night rain.
You know what? Good enough.
What's that?
I'm alive, but I'm almost not. I don't have the luxury to go after him.
Hey, he almost killed you. Go back out there and find him.
No. I'm gonna pick the phone back up. Pick the comlink back up and be like, I think I got him.
Although, Hooli, I'm gonna say, because that was badass, you get 2 points of edge. Get out. What were we gonna say?
He's gone, but I don't know if there's gotta be more. We gotta hit the streets. I don't know what the hell's going on with this. This is more than a coincidence.
Are my spirits there? Can they go after the guy?
Your spirits can arrive, although no one knows what this guy looks like. Because, like, they were shooting at each other through a door.
Well, as long as they can, like, stay here and make sure that he doesn't come back and murder me.
Yeah, because this guy needs some help. Well, Hooli would physically probably bleed to death, because how much health do you have left?
3.
Yeah, maybe you can try it.
And that's without taking any shots from that.
So you are a boat dancing motherfucker.
Yes.
Yeah, you get 2 points of karma too. That was awesome. Anyway, so are you coming there with your spirits in order to heal him?
I'm much slower than my spirits. I am on my way there, but my spirits are way faster than I am.
So you have those motorcycles, don't forget.
Yeah, I'm not going to pick up.
You're going to take those?
No,
okay.
Nope.
So there are more like pill-shaped pods that are taxi cabs, although those cost 20 new yen to use. Okay, so you hop on a pod over there, and by the time you get there, you see like a bunch of parked cars, and you actually see a pair of police cruisers interviewing people, or a pair of police cruisers parked, and officers in white Kevlar vests and body plating and helmets over black jumpsuits are questioning people about what they saw, and you have a forensics, what do you call them? One of those necromancer mages analyzing the blood trail going down the main cobblestone steps.
A blood mage, huh?
No, necromancer. Because the necromancers in 5th edition tend to be like forensics guys.
I know. It's a joke.
Oh, okay. I thought you were saying, like, oh, a blood mage attacked him. Like, no, you wouldn't be alive if a blood mage attacked you.
God. My character would make a little comment on just use the necromancer like, ah, blood maiden's here already, huh?
So, the spirits go up and protect him, and, you know, the cops aren't going to let that guy come back, probably. And are you going to go up there and try and heal him? I mean, the elevator still works.
Yeah.
Like, they advise you, hey man, take the elevator, the stairs need to be scanned. You can make a sneaking check and try to get some from upstairs. Because the officer is on the staircase, not on the floor where the actual shootout occurred. Not quite yet. So you can probably grab a sample there. Are you sure? Because, like I said, the police is on the, or the cop is on the stairwell, not on the upper floor. It's gonna like rub your finger along a droplet of blood and take a sample.
Okay. So I'll whip up a little stealth alchemical thing. And take it. And get a air spirit to put force mine concealment on, and then I'll sneak down there and get a blood sample.
You don't need to sneak down to where the officer is.
Well, no, sneak down to where the blood is.
Well, the blood is like right by the guy's door, and I said there isn't a cop on that level.
Oh, okay.
All right. So, like, literally, you just have to wait until I have to make sure the cop's not up there. Reach down, like. Rub your finger in it, and then we'll go inside your friend's house.
Oh, okay, cool.
Yeah, it's like, why are you willing to make a potion? It's not like you're breaking into Fort Knox.
I was thinking I had to, like, go down some stairs to a landing, and then, like, there, you know, the cop was, like, down just, like, another little set of stairs, and could easily see where I was going to be going to, but it was, like, a totally different level.
Yeah, no, they're on a stair landing. You're on another level. You're fine.
Cool, well, I'm gonna have to look up how to fucking track somebody with their blood, damn it.
Well, you can get, like, his, I guess you could say genetic blueprint from the sample. You don't know the guy's name or anything, but you can, like, cross-reference it against other genetic samples.
There's magic you can do when you have somebody's, like, a leftover, like, blood to trap people down.
Oh, yeah, there's that.
Just checked our Discord, and like 4 or 5 minutes ago, Deadeye said it's getting pretty late, guys, and Von Zook said already asleep.
Well, if you want, we can actually make this mission a two-parter and end it after he does some investigation.
Yeah, because we also lost Coach.
Oh, like he's just straight up gone.
Yeah.
Oh, shit. I thought I knew he had to go somewhere, but, oh, shit. Oh, yeah, okay, because his connection was dying. Oh, that was, like, almost an hour ago. What the fuck? How long have we been recording? Oh, actually, quite a while. Anyway, so, yeah, grab the blood sample, do some investigation, and we'll call it a session. How's that?
Yeah. Yeah, that's good. That gives me time to research how to actually track somebody's blood, so that when I come to the next game, we just hop into it, just let me take it.
Oh, I'm saying right now you have a spirit try and follow the trail. See, I'm pretty lenient about these sort of things. I'm not going to make you go through every book. It's like, hey, go to book 183, page 9, paragraph 7, subsection 83. You know.
I guess probably the simplest way would be let the spirit sense the trail.
Okay.
I have to figure out directly who it is by us. That's in the end.
You guys let the rest of us know what's going on?
At some point, yeah. Probably. Hey.
Okay. So then what am. Yes or no?
You know what? Yeah, I'd let you guys know what happened to me.
Okay. Well, I have a full mechanic shop, and if there's anything on the bikes, I would be able to pick it up.
The only thing on the bike is those temporary ownership licenses.
Oh.
Like, there's no trackers.
I literally could remove all trackers. I could do a full sweep through them. There could be literally nothing to track us.
Yeah, the only trackers on there are the grid guide links. That's it.
You know what? Best idea? Yeah, but it would still be the best idea to just wipe the whole thing, like completely take it off the matrix.
I mean, those could be ghost bikes at this point. I could make them that way.
I've got
the highest level of mechanics on building and taking stuff down. So while we're preparing for this,
I'll give you heal that repairs 9 boxes of physical damage.
Swiggity swag, I'm back up.
Woohoo!
I mean, I've got a full vehicle chop shop.
But yeah, getting those bikes as ghost as possible would be the best idea.
That's what my character's built to do.
Thank you, Zhizhao.
Alright. So, while Zhizhao, gives you the healing potion that she makes, with her third eye, she's able to see what the spirit sees, and she follows the guy's, aura, because he was in pain, so she's able to follow, the pain trail back to where he went. Although, he stops suddenly when, he gets close to a certain place in the city. Let me double check where I put this. They cross over. He gets to the bridge to Xingyi, right? And it stopped. The bridge that would go over the water to Xingyi. The spirit just cannot continue. And when you look through the spirit's eye, what you see is, the five-pronged, the pentagram with the prongs being earth, metal, air, water, fire. And then that's like the central peak of a big golden W. The spirit can see it, that's not really there, but it's like a barrier keeping that spirit from entering.
Probably bougie.
Is it a mana barrier or a spirit barrier?
It's stopping the spirit from getting through.
And both of them would technically stop the spirit.
I just put magical barrier, shit.
Roll a d6. 1 through 3, that's 1. 1, 5, 6, 7.
Yeah, it's a magic barrier. Or a mana barrier. And what did you say, Hilo?
The mark the location of Queens.
Who do you think that would be?
Were you guys not even curious what that symbol is?
out of game, it's probably the Wuxing symbol, so that they know not to, so that people know not to go and fuck around in it. But on the other hand, I have to imagine Wuxing's pretty thorough about trying to get street mages off the street. But, I couldn't imagine why in-game I wouldn't think that, Hooli wouldn't think that.
Yeah, it just makes sense. Protecting their territory.
So you could roll your area knowledge to see if you recognize that symbol.
But I would. But I do. And I presume you would, let us know about this?
Yeah.
Go Deadeye! You guys send Deadeye a description of what on earth you're seeing. And he's like, oh yeah, that's the Wuxing. If it's over a golden W, then it's probably the Wuxing Corporation.
Yeah.
I like to believe that he's not this guy who tries to kill you as works as the Wuxing Corporation.
Wait a minute. That might mean... Tonics. I try to conjure up what a W might mean, and then I just remember... I can be hooked on phones. But, corporation? It's more than... likely that this Johnson is... Wooshing. So either I just try to fuck with Wooshing stuff, or the Johnson is wanting us to fuck with Wooshing stuff.
Do any of you guys have Wooshing knowledge? Corporation knowledge?
I've got data havens. Sounds like a cool bowl of noodles.
I should like try that. Because they're one of the Big Ten.
Oh yeah, you've heard of them. But I'm saying, like, you could roll their knowledge and be able to tell their practices and whether or not you were working for them.
Yeah. Pretty much the only things we would know common knowledge would be whatever kind of propaganda bullshit they spew at us.
Yeah, and that's like they're super Chinese and they love the Wooshing symbol. I mean, their corporation is named after it.
You know, I
is
think
it worth sending my spirit to try to sneak through it?
I thought you said you were going to try and not
I have.
Do that.
I mean... Probably if it fails, there's still an actual signature that's pinned to me. They might be able to track with it.
It'd probably be the best idea not to fuck with a corp unless we, A, are getting paid to do it, or B, 100% know that they are the ones that are going on right now.
Well, I was just going to follow in to try to get that guy specifically. Not like specific part of the corp, per se.
True, but it just seems like one of those things that it'd be better if we all went together and tried to do that, and I don't think everybody's willing to, stop in the middle of getting some money just to murder up on some guy that tried to kill me.
Okay, well, we have some blood, so I can probably track it later. This might be the last chance we get to track down, so... Right, I'm not going to do anything about this.
Yeah. Yeah, that's true. I think for now I'll just go homeless again. I've done it before, I'll do it again.
I have a hole that you can hide out in.
I owe you 2. I owe you 3.
There's a reason that the Wampo know and respect like they do.
And don't forget, you did complete that fake buy order.
Okay, so that's...
You did complete it, I said.
Between the bridge, between Mirror Shades and Pink Mohawk.
Also, here's a cheap prepaid comlink for you to transfer that orb over to, so that you can still drive the bike around without having it on your actual comlink anymore. I don't know how you do that, but you're decorative.
Alright. Plus, you know, saying of having a vest of comlinks makes you invisible on the Matrix. It's not actually true, but I'm a superstitious dwarf.
By the way, you know that I do try to keep these games comfortably in the mirror shades area, right?
I'm trying so hard.
Well, I know that it tends to vary depending on who you ask, but to me, mirror shades is the one in the middle.
Oh. I thought mirror shades was just another name for black trench coat.
It, sometimes it is, sometimes it's actually worse than black trench coat. I always do like the middle ground though, and because Molly is my favorite fictional character ever, I decided to name my game mode after her.
Usually, it's either like the same as black trench coat, or from what I've heard, like you say, a blend between the two.
I've actually heard people say that it's like black trench coat hardcore mode. I've only heard it like twice though, but yeah, I always hear it's one of those three, and I always just pick playing it in the middle, since that tends to be the most fun.
Because you can like slide the scale either way depending on how the group is.
Exactly.
Or pink mohawk, you can slide things a little bit that way. It's a good way to go.
Exactly.
Very good. Smart. That's pretty much the best way to GM, so that you can deal with upcoming problems.
Exactly.
Stuff comes up that you're not expecting, it can really throw you off and like you just want to know what to do because you're not practiced to, you know, respond to new situations.
Hell, were you in the Discord chat when I told everybody about the first Prime Mercenary campaign I ever tried to run and how disastrous that went?
Yeah, I also remember reading about that on the Shadowrun Discord.
Yeah, man, that was awful. Yeah, it was the first time I ever GM'd a Prime Mercenary campaign, and I played one before, and it was really fun. We were, like, island hopping through space stations, like space station hopping, on our way to the Evo base and taking it over for Ares, right?
That's pretty cool.
Yeah, that was, well, because Mercenary games are, like, the high insanity Shadowrun games, and the team I played with, you know, they're typically D&D players, so they wanted to play an action-focused game, and I thought, oh, okay. And it was the first time I ever GM'd both a Prime group or a Merc group. So, when these guys bought all this ludicrous gear, I wasn't really sure how to deal with it. And I put up obstacles in their way, and they just, like, were able to say, oh, well, this thingy solves that problem immediately. Oh, okay, well now there's this problem. Oh, this thingy solves it immediately, you know? And I thought, like, okay, shit. Because, like, it was pretty clear that, you know, nothing I had written was going to challenge these guys, and I didn't want them to get bored. So that's when I cranked the difficulty meter up to James Bond. And it's like, okay, Loffler wants you guys to wipe out all the Vorian Germany as a test. I didn't tell him that it was a test, but it was a test, and if they wiped out all the Vori, he was going to hire them to assassinate a dragon on the moon and on Mars.
Wow. I mean, that sounds like some Prime Runner shit.
Well, also mercenaries, because if you're a mercenary, your availability for items at the start goes up, and you get triple the resources. So they had, like, availability 18 with 1.5 million new yen at the start. And what's funny is, so these guys had, like, assault jets and shit, and the person who hired them, I told you about the dragon free spirit, they just attacked unprovoked.
Yeah.
And then they got mad when this free spirit dragon from the first age, or first world, just crumpled up one of their attack jets like it was paper.
Dragons are pretty crazy.
Like, it emptied its missiles and its bullets at her. She's like, bitch, please. And it's like, telepathically crushed the thing. And then left.
Awesome.
And then they threw the biggest fit. And the reason they got mad at the Johnson is because, like, they thought that the Vori were too dangerous for them. These guys with a bunch of Alpha Wear and... Actually, no, they had Delta Wear. with like a bunch of military grade Delta wear, military grade weapons, armor, vehicles. They were supposed to be like these badass mercenaries. Were scared of Vori. And because the Johnson refused to pay, I think they wanted like $100,000 each for the do the mission to kill Vori. And she said, no, screw you guys, and was going to leave. And they threatened to kill her if she didn't come back and pay him more and give him the cure to that virus thing.
Wow.
Because the virus I had to make up to get them to do the fucking mission. Yeah, and
yes or no to a job, and that's it.
Yeah, they said no. She was going to leave, and then they opened fire on her because she wouldn't pay them more or give them the cure. And I even said to them, you know, if you kill her, she won't get, she won't be alive to give you the cure, right?
Not to mention, if you kill a Johnson, your notoriety goes up like crazy high.
Yeah, and they were in Berlin. Yeah. But it's funny, they actually had a second group that did something similar to that, although it wasn't as bad. Like, we actually got them to do the job, but they just didn't. That game just fell apart because they weren't into it. Whereas the other group, like, they were just whiny.
Well, I have to say, this was a great deal of fun.
Yeah, and we can do part two, I guess, any other time, because this is a two-parter one-shot. I didn't know such a thing existed.
Yeah, and I will, for Deadeye and Bonzook, I will try and be more... I just felt like I took over the whole session, and I feel like a dick.
Eh, that tends to happen when you have very Matrix-focused legwork. I was trying to think, like, okay, how on earth do I incorporate these assholes?
Matrix and magic consume an insane amount of in-game time. That's why I tried to get my magic rolls just out of the way. Instead of eating up time, but decking it's kind of more difficult to do.
Yeah, I was sitting there thinking, okay, how can I have Von Zook spend, like, 20 minutes doing recon? You know, give him some time.
It's harder because you have to respond to everything he does and give him input, like, so he can't just like throw a bunch of things out there and be like, okay, that's the next day or whatever.
Yeah, I think the one time, so the one other time I had a rigger, I was able to get away with having a lot more investigation due to like much more complex areas, and there was a whole system where it's like she could be attacked in a similar way, like a Decker, while she was controlling her drones, you know?
Yeah, and plus, you know, with a rigger, they can be in meat space and be contributing in meat space way more than they would be in the Matrix, whereas with a Decker, I mean, that's really it.
Yeah, they can't really meat space it while decking.
Yeah, and while it's a little more manageable, I imagine it's going to be a little more when we're in the actual run, you know, once we break the doors down and steal everything.
Everything but what you're there to steal.
Yeah.
I actually have a friend who...
You didn't say we couldn't take everything in the shop.
I actually have a friend who thinks just like that, His character is a ghoul blood adept. And he started out as a brawler adept, got ghoulified, and then I can't remember how, but like by some sheer accident or some it was like an external thing that made him go blood. I think it had something to do with him becoming a ghoul. And it was just so funny, because he's the kind of guy who will go barreling in head first without any intention of completing the mission and somehow do better than the rest of the party at completing it.
Maybe the bold moves? So?
Maybe.
I know in... I want to say it's in Run Faster. Everything's in Run Faster.
Yeah.
There's a positive quality. It's either a positive or a negative, I don't remember. But basically, it just rewards you for playing the game exactly like that. Just...
Oh, yeah.
Don't do legwork, just fucking go.
I know what you're talking about. I really need to give him that. Because we didn't have Run Faster, because we started playing 2 years ago. It was... I played a little bit of, it was either 3rd or 4th edition, but it kind of had, like, some of Cyberpunk 2020 mixed in. I played that for a few months. Then I got a hold of the 5th edition core rulebook. And for over a year and a half, we just played with the 5th edition core rulebook. And I had to make up more cyberware, more guns, more stuff. And then, I found these other supplement books that I could buy and download. I'm just going through these supplements thinking, holy shit!
Yeah, like, especially Run Faster.
I don't know how I got along without Run Faster, because I almost always play Hobgoblins.
Yeah, and I've, for a really, really long time, I've wanted to play a Changeling.
I'd be fine with it, I would just need to learn how they work.
I'm so used to it because pretty much my entire time I've played pen and papers, have a good one.
Good night, Von Zook. Yeah, we're gonna end the stream soon. We stopped playing Shadowrun. Now we're just talking about Shadowrun.
Yeah. But my whole experience with pen and papers has basically been. As a GM, so I've always been the guy who knows the lore, or knows the rule, or knows where the book that has the rule. So when I'm just having like a casual conversation with people about Shadowrun, I just immediately go into that like. I also talk to so many people who know literally nothing about Shadowrun or pen and papers, so I go into that mode of like, okay, time to crash course this person in Shadowrun. So when I'm actually talking to people who've been doing Shadowrun for more than likely longer than me, I kind of have to reel myself back and say, no, these people know that Ares Macro Technology is, you know, the most military corporation.
Yeah.
I need to tell these people.
Well, what's funny is, I actually played with him. He's a really cool guy in the Discord chat about lore and what, or about like canon and what role it should have in the game. And I always put player freedom over canon. Like, you know, me and my friends, we play our games in the 60s because a lot of really cool shit happened there, and we. Pretty much like the first campaign we ever played was explaining how the corporations got a hold of East Berlin again. Because remember, there was that time in the 60s where it was reunited. And the whole campaign was about them recovering a rogue AI that escaped Cyderkrupp's control and bringing it back to Cyderkrupp. And the whole campaign was like, them being hired by various factions to keep stealing the same AI or steal it back from the people they stole it for before. And, stuff like that. And so, at the very end, East Berlin was united, and they got this AI to sort of play nice with Cyderkrupp. And that's how it's been, you know, that's been super fun, but nowhere in the canon is that the case. And so it's kind of a case where, do you acknowledge the canon and take away player freedom? Or do you let the players have fun, you know?
Yeah, like, for me, because I've had maybe 5 or 6 groups that I've GM'd for, and one of the things I do is I give them a free fixer named Jack. he's an orc who's in his 50s, and he's like the one binding thing that puts all of my Shadowrun campaigns in the same universe.
Ah, cool, I love it. I love doing that.
And one thing, like the one big run that me and my group will remember for a real long time is basically the Vori had kidnapped Jack's nephew, and like all of his Vori contacts had gone to ground, or basically everybody just went silent about it for one reason or another, and he was like, okay, listen guys, I will pay you both like 50,000 new yen. Find my nephew, tell me what's going on, but don't move on him. When you find him, let me know. So, like, three runs, really, later, they find the kid, and they were about to move in, extract him, and they were like, no, no, no. So they call him, and they're like, hey, what do you want us to do? And he's like, right, get the kid and get as far away from the area as you can. So that's what they did. They went barreling in, just like I thought they would, just like I knew they would, because they're people hawks as fuck. they just barrel in, blow away as many people as they can, grab the kid, run out, and like 5 seconds later, a set of jets come flying over the and carpet bomb the whole building.
God damn.
And it took out like 3 city blocks of the Barons.
Oh lord.
And so now whenever any character is like, man, where can I find this one piece of gear? We all remind ourselves, oh yeah, Jack, he carpet bombed the Barons.
You know, you're lucky that you can have a group that you can categorize as all pink mohawk or black trench coat. Because me and my 3 pals, who I've been playing with since the beginning, they are like, one of them has a veritable fleet of mirror shades that he wears. One of them is black trench coat like a motherfucker. And one of them is so pink mohawk, they had to invent a new shade of pink. And I have to keep these 3 people, like, working the same missions. But, also, this is something I've been kind of curious about, but I've been afraid to ask the rule Nazis on Shadowcasters. How often do people shy away from the stereotypical run format of Shadowrun? Because I've never seen another GM in Roll 20 do that. I can only think of myself and my friend Andy, who have had Shadowrun campaigns that don't follow the traditional pattern.
I guess that kind of depends on what you mean by stereotypical.
Well, it's like, it's the meet with the Johnson, legwork, run, and then the meeting, doing
payment.
Yeah, the payment and the conclusion of the job, you know. Like, those are the 4 steps that I've been told every run has to follow, and I thought, really? Because the campaign I did, half of the shit they did was not even shadow running. It was just them doing their own work, you know, like their own jobs and stuff.
I had a character like that. One of the first characters I ever GM'd for. God, he was such a weeb. His name was Raiden. And he was a physical adept, like all of our players. And he specialized in katanas. Like, just, I think he rolled 16 die whenever he used a katana, and that was just baseline. No extra bonuses, no high ground or any bullshit like that. Just
okay.
Straight up, 16 die.
Ah!
And then later, he turned it into like 21 die. Sorry, because he turned his katana into like a force five or four, six Bokai.
Oh, shit.
And had the karma to bind it. So I couldn't tell him no.
Yes, you can. You're the GM. You can always find a reason to say no. Even if you...
I'm just one of those GMs that I really despise just straight up saying no.
Oh, I wholly understand. Like, again, if I knew how to play him, I would... Or if I knew how to GM him, I would gladly let you play Changeling. I just have no idea how. Like, the whole reason I started Hong Kong Hub, really, was, because I looked at Runner Hub and, ShadowNet, and thought, wow, these do not look like fun, because they told the player, like, you can't do this, you can't do this, you can't do this, but they didn't add anything
Shadow
back.
ShadowNet is the more fun one?
You mean Runner Hub?
ShadowNet's the more fun one, but it's not as fun. Or is Runner Hub? I thought ShadowNet was the more, slightly less restrictive.
No, ShadowNet has all the same house rules as Runner Hub, I think, and actually more restrictions, and it takes longer to unlock certain things, and you have to go through that whole bureaucratic cycle to get shit.
Okay, so like Runner Hub is the slightly better one.
Yeah, like, I could...
About, like, joining them just to have more, you know, access to more games and, like, ones that I could fill in my schedule when I want, but so much fucking work.
I know, it's like...
Just
with.
Like, get to a point where you somewhat decent character. It's so restricted. Like, some of my favorite qualities that I like for characters is they make sense for Shadow, like in debt and like day job. Like,
yeah, that's what I really hated is that there were some that, yeah, or erased.
It makes sense for a lot of sense for the Shadowrunners to take. Like, every Shadowrunner should probably have a little bit of debt realistically while you're running a Shadow.
Yeah.
You know, you got paper.
Like, there were so many character concepts that you cannot do because of their house rules, you know? Like, Erase was one of them that really bothered me, because it means you cannot play a character who at any point in their life had a sin without it. Because Erase means, you know, you had your sin burned.
Which, I mean, for a sinner, that's the end of your life right there.
Yeah, it's like, oh, hey, you know, I had a sin, and then I fell in the shadows after the Mafia killed my family, and... Yeah, we were corporate citizens, but we weren't important enough for Wu Xing to avenge us, you know? So I had to take matters into my own hand and burn my sin so I couldn't be tracked. Or hell, my, a character that I actually had for a while, and thankfully, due to the GM pulling some miraculous bullshit, she was able to retire alive. She was the daughter of my first main character ever in Shadowrun, and, you know, he got a ton of money, he retired, he was like 48 when he retired, because, you know, we started in the 60s and played through to the 70s, and she was born in Germany. We moved to the Algonquin Council after Cider Krupp tried to kill us. She got a sin, she went to school, all of that, and then after my character was assassinated by Cider Krupp, after saving the world, she... burned her sin in order to go into, you know, the shadows and then assassinate the people who killed him. You know? Like, so I never could have played my character's daughter trying to avenge him on Runner Hub or ShadowNet.
And, see, I think that's why they are so restrictive, because from what I understand is they're trying to have persistent world, and while for a small group like us, or my groups or your groups, that's not too bad, because you can make one group the main characters, it's very easy to like let's say you have two GMs who are running game, who are going to have runs that occur on the same day in that world, and let's say they're both in Seattle, because it's always Seattle, why not?
You know, I'm gonna actually tell you something about that when you're done, but go on.
if one team, let's just use this as an example, has half of the Baron's carpet bombed, and the other team is in the Barrens at that same time, well, then you necessarily have to either retcon it and say, oh wait, actually your run happened either before or a couple months later, or you say, you know, it's two different timelines, and then you get into timeline creep like Marvel and DC are having right now. That's why they're trying to reinvent the wheel for the 8 million.
Well, you know, speaking of DC, I've actually worked with comic books. I know how editorial mandate works, so I think I can pull off what you're describing just fine. Because I've had to work with a shared universe. All right. Good night, Deadeye. Everybody say good night to Deadeye. Because I had to work in a... I didn't work for Marvel or DC, but I had to work in a shared universe where there were 23 other writers. We would write comics weekly. And put them out, and they were black and white, so, you know, the artist was fast, and they were amazing. And we were able to keep a consistent universe without retcons, without alternate timelines, just because we had good communication. And that was with superhero insanity. Now, I imagine something like Shadowrun, where, because it's Hong Kong Hub, I'm going to stream it, or at least, if other people GM, we would say that the stream is canon. When I upload this, I'm going to put it in the media. Don't worry, Deadeye. People are going to see this. It's just that I'm not entirely sure how... Like, if the stream crashed because so many people were watching it, I'm not sure how to fix that. And then I don't want to lose a bunch of stuff because of that.
Yeah, more than likely, it would just crash your OBS.
Yeah, exactly. And I don't want that because me and my friends, we did a podcast a while ago. And we lost, like, 45 minutes of the video because even though we paused the stream, when we restarted it, it actually did not save what we had before. Even though it was a stream and everything was in one continuous video. And, like, it had the same time, so it still said the whole thing was, like, an hour and a half. But even no matter how many times we started it, it would always just stop. It would always begin at the 45-minute mark, no matter what.
Oh, that sucks.
Yeah, I know. But, with the whole Hong Kong thing, and playing how you mentioned, you know, Seattle's always the default setting, it's something that I didn't really notice before, but I tried testing it, and I could not find a single podcast or game group that took place outside of Seattle. And I thought, well, that's fucking boring. So, there's a Turok 2? Oh, cool.
Yeah, and someone in here was playing. I want to say it was the guy who was...
Well, anyway, what I was saying is, like, I was wondering, you know, there's a bunch of lore and really cool stuff in Shadowrun. And I didn't know anything about it until, I never really thought to look at it until... One of my friends wanted to play a character from Spain, right? Like, that was where he was from. You know, he was a mercenary in Spain, then left. And I thought, okay, that was cool. So I looked up what Spain was like in Shadowrun. And it's sort of like Attack on Titan, if you've ever seen that, where the city is arranged in rings, you know? And it's like, the furthest out ring is a sprawl, or like a, you know, the barons. The middle ring is, like, low-wage slave city, and the central area is, like, the corporate playground. And the city is besieged by critters, just like Attack on Titan. And while also having its own, you know, shadow community. And that's when I realized, you know, Hong Kong's a cool place. I loved it when I was there. And it didn't have a lot of lore after 2063. So I picked it to be, like, a... Yeah, exactly, because that way, no one can bitch at me and say what I'm doing is wrong, you know?
Yeah, there's very little precedent, it means you get to make up stuff as you go.
Exactly.
And there's no chance of us being like, wait, that doesn't fit, you know?
Like, that thing in the mall, like, people, if this was Seattle, people would say, oh, if that was happening in Seattle, like that thing in the mall, people would have investigated it, you know? It's like, oh, hey, it's Hong Kong, you know? You ever play Shadowrun Hong Kong for the... Or by Harebrained Schemes? That's basically the precedent I'm using, and that was 30 years before this game takes place.
Yeah, and that's one thing that I try to explain to one of my players, because the group that I've run with, we've known each other for like 10 years, and we've played lots of different games together. And what I found is that the less lore the players know going in, the better. They could have every mechanic memorized, etched in their skin, that's fine. But the less lore they know, the better.
Exactly.
It means that,
they won't try and fight you on every single thing.
Yeah, because I remember...
Yeah.
Yeah, and I mean, I'm one of the kinds of people that I like to work within limits, I guess. But it was just I tried to GM the Star Wars Saga Edition, which is it's D20 based. So.
Oh yeah, I know that game. It's pretty fun.
Yeah, and we did in the KOTOR era, so.
I was just I played Edge and it was fucking terrible. When he said Star Wars, I had like a fucking trauma event for a second, so I figured it was the different one. Yeah, that game was so bad, and I'm like actually like a little bit scarred from it.
I actually really liked Edge of the Empire. It was the first game. It was
like 2.5 years. It was so bad. It's not made for longevity.
Yeah, I know exactly what you're talking about, though, man. It's one of the two... It's like I said, the reasons I made Hong Kong. I want to explore settings outside of Seattle, and Hong Kong's a cool place. And because of the complete absence of lore, I can pretty much do almost whatever the hell I want.
Yeah.
Like, I'm not sure if you noticed, Huli, because you kind of just joined today. But if you go to the Important Character tab, or Important Character Information tab... I have it in there mentioned how I changed the priority system for this hub. Because...
I was there when you were talking to... I think it was Discordia, and she was like, hey, since there's way more orcs than humans, shouldn't you switch the priority around? And you were like, oh, fuck!
Yeah!
You got a point there!
Which is funny, I didn't realize that, because that's something my friend Beard and I have actually talked about several times, like... because orcs are so common, shouldn't they be higher on, or shouldn't they be lower on the priority table, like, at least D, if not E? Because orcs, I'm surprised, haven't taken over humanity as the majority, given the fact that they mature faster, they give birth in litters, and,
yeah, they breed faster.
Yeah.
Like, overall, everything about their birth cycle is quicker.
Yeah, that's why I'm wondering, it's like, how come orcs haven't... Yeah, I mean...
Because, as we must always remember, in every setting, no matter what, the one universal rule is that humans are A, the default, and B, the master race.
Don't let people in Hong Kong catch you saying that. Because, again, part of me being able to just make up the lore is I was able to say that, like, Hong Kong is 65% orcs. You know, only 18% humans.
Yeah...
Fuck you. 6% elves, 6% dwarves, 3% trolls, 2% other. Because humans are boring and orcs are awesome.
True, although I have to say, no setting has better orcs than Warhammer 40,000.
Oh, yes! I love them because they're like one of the only two armies that seems to actually have any fun with what they're doing.
Well, that's because fun isn't the point of 40K. It's the grim, dark darkness of the grim, dark future where everything is dark and grim.
Dude, that is the most narmtastic game I've ever played. For those of you...
Because...
For those of you familiar with your TV tropes, you know.
Yeah, it's because everybody takes... so seriously.
I know.
While I love playing like preacher type characters, so being able to have a hard-boiled basically preacher is really fun for me as a role player, but I've never gotten to play. I've never gotten to like play as a player Deathwatch.
Aww. I'm sorry.
Really, my whole experience with pen and paper is can be summed up with, I like this game system, but I've never got to play it.
See, I'm glad that that Shadowrun is my favorite everything. Like, it has everything I want out of a sci-fi setting and a fan. It's my ideal tabletop game made reality. There's nothing more I want. I love cyberpunk more than anything. I love fantasy. I love, like, the criminal element of it. It's like, I have nothing more I can ask for. Oh, and the system's good, too.
I mean, maybe some minor tweaks on how some stuff works, but the whole general overall idea of it is exactly the way we're getting the tabletop game.
See, the only reason I tweak the mechanics is to keep the difficulty from, like, crushing the players, and to keep the game from getting bogged down. Because I can't tell you how many times I've gotten into fights, in-game I mean, and then completely lost track of what was happening in the sea of soak rolls, dodge rolls, how many bullets hit, what fire modes we're using, action numbers. They're like, okay, come on, we gotta speed this shit up. You know?
Yeah, I really get the sense that they wanted to make a video game.
Yeah.
And I just didn't feel like it.
Well, cause I remember I showed the rulebook to my friend, and he even said, if he encoded every action in this game to, like, a computer, you would have, like, 2/3 of a video game. The only real...
It is that mechanical.
Yeah.
It really is that mechanical.
Again, for those of you watching, you know, feel free to join the Hong Kong Hub, where I'm light on lore, rules, and lax on most things, as you've probably seen. So just step up, submit your soul, and then you can join the Hub. What?
Pretty low cost.
I know. See, I...
Just my soul? Good. I've got more than enough of that to go around.
See, I was born a redhead, so I don't have to worry. I need other people's souls. Why do you think my Discord handle is the Mad Lich? I mean, it's Lu Mong now because I'm on, like, the Shadowcasters Network, and I like to keep my name, like, whatever my main character is. But, officially I'm known as the Mad Lich. Because I like to steal souls. And, oh god, it's 1 in the morning here. We should probably end the stream.
Yeah, I'm still gonna walk my dog, so it's a good idea.
It's 4 a.m. where I...
Oh, okay, I'll let you go, man. It's been fun. See y'all next time. This has been Madman Robbie, your host and evil overlord, signing off. Good morning, everybody.
Thanks for running the game, and